So we are going to have our 50th CPC. CPC stands for Coffee for Churcha. We started this exercise about a year and a half back, basically to give more opportunities to our members to interact with our charter members. Charter members are very senior and highly successful entrepreneurs. So there has always been a sort of remark that during our program they don't get enough time to interact. So we said we will have another sort of platform for our members to interact with the senior charter members in a very sort of informal sort of environment. That's how we started it. And we had 14 of our charter members conducting this CPC. Normally this is hosted by them. And so 14 of them had hosted. And each time, I said this before also, when we get out of this hall after the event, we felt that this was the best. So I'm sure that we have another very highly distinguished entrepreneur today. Ajay, many of you know that he's a young and vibrant charter member, but very experienced in his field. So he's going to share his experience. He is the CEO of a company called Bipha Ayurveda, which is an old company set up in 1929 in South Kerala. Now they are now in operating out of Kottayam. But it was very beginning an innovative company. It had several firsts. I believe this is the company first started this tablets and cashews formulations in Kerala, actually. That's a great thing. Earlier I remember that during our childhood we used to have this roots to be boiled and then made a kashayam and then all that. So now it's very simple. But Ajay is a third generation entrepreneur, but he has done something which the two generations of his predecessors could not do or did not do. And he has converted this company into a very vibrant, responsive, state-of-the-art lifestyle company. And having presence in 15 countries actually. Something which he has done in about 20 plus years. He joined in 1989 or something. So very short. But I'm telling you, this is really going to be an exciting session. He'll be sharing his exciting journey, entrepreneurial journey with us. So my great pleasure to invite him.
Thank you. So as Casey said, Ajay is one of the youngest we have in we have among the time charter members. So there's actually a disguise. He tends to behave a little older than what is that? He's only younger than only one younger than him is probably Bipha. So
youngest Prithvi is talking about.
No, I'm still younger than that.
Yeah. So some things interesting about Bipha, and I'm sure you'll hear the Bipha, and I'm sure you'll hear the story from Ajay as well. Even if you look at the pharma industry, and they say that, you know, there are several game-changing moments, and one of those game-changing moments in pharma was the introduction of tablets. So Bipha did to Ayurveda what, you know, that particular movement was in pharma or in the general medicine industry, converting those kashayams into capsules, which I think was one of those huge game changes. Ayurveda, I'm sure all of you know about Ayurveda, and you know, you've heard, I think every Malayali is proud of the Ayurveda heritage that we have. And I think more and more we are accepting it as medicine. It's not alternate medicine, it is medicine. And it is medicine, and it has clinical methods, and it's as elaborate as some of the other sciences in pharmacology and in medicine. So we'll hear the story from, for those of you, I see some new faces since you've not seen a Coffee for Churcha. This is not a full-time presentation of, you know, 2.5 hours by Ajay. So there is a first half of this where Ajay takes you through the Bipha story and his experiences in Ayurveda plus the health and wellness space. And then post that, we have a short break, we come back, and then there's a lot of questions and discussions on what he's presented. And of course, if he has more to present as well, we'll accommodate in that session. Typically, I try to prepare a summary for those Coffee for Charchas I am there. I think from this session onwards, I'll also send you the summary for those of you, you know, who couldn't take notes. So I take copious notes during the, you know, during the talk and send it to you.
All the other. Thank you very much. And good afternoon. Yeah. And thanks a lot for that. I think I'm audible, right? So thanks a lot for the wonderful. I don't think I've heard my history better than Casey and very eloquently Rajesh has in the format of CPC. You know, I was quite surprised when I was asked to do CPC because, you know, so yeah, you know, Thai is a very, very rich organization. I always give a lot to Thai for what it has given Kerala entrepreneurs. And one of it definitely is me. Because it's got a very, very rich, experienced CMs from where you learn a lot, who's kind of probably encouraging every other to come up to also be like them. So in a place like Kerala, it's very important that, you know, we need this whole thing called encouragement. And I guess Thai is all full of it. When I was driving down, I was asking more, you know, somebody who wanted to come, I said, you know, you please make sure that you always move to such meetings because in Kerala we don't believe that we'll have to do all these things. We expect things to come to us. They said, you know, I always used to be in the sideline of the CI meetings and TI meetings, always in the last bench. But I always used to go for that. So, in fact, it's all those small snippets that we get from these meetings that, you know, we learn and we grow. So, just for a small introduction, I thought I'd like to share this one because I feel that it's really helped me as an entrepreneur in my journey, so let me acknowledge what I have seen and understand. So, and of course, I'm sure that everyone will be providing maybe copy of notes. I think I'd like to really have a copy of that because that would be one of the most eloquent and, you know, lightly worded briefs of what I would possibly say. Okay. So, I'll try to do my best, so please, if you would like the format to be changed, any questions to be asked, or if you think you want to hear a better side of the story, I'm always happy to really change my course. So I'd like to try to make it as entertaining as possible, if it's possible. But you're free to change the course, right? So possibly I'm just telling about, I don't know how many people know about Bipha, by the way. I hope everybody knows.
Would you like them to introduce?
Yeah, if you can do that, if you can make quick introductions, I mean. Yeah. Or maybe, yeah.
I'm AB Chirai. I am the managing partner of Transcend Business Solutions. We are into connecting startups and existing business to be fund houses and VC.
I'm Johnson. I'm not an entrepreneur.
Excellent.
I started my career 40 years back as an industrial market researcher. Personally involved in suggesting ideas and products.
Great, thanks.
I'm Nipu. I'm from Global Business Applications, which is a software development company focusing on mobile platforms. So
it's a
Tycon
app.
Oh, yeah.
That's
yeah,
great.
Tycon is really doing very well.
Yes, it's 7. All thanks to Tycon for all the support to the
sure, that's what it does.
My name is Micho Thomas. My company name is Career Kerala. We are into HR services. That's it. Yeah.
Hi all. My name is Micho Thomas. I am representing Bipha Technologies. So technology is iClipsCore.com. So this is the first time I am attending here at Thai MT. So happy to be here.
I'm Hemant Prakash. I represent Subhira Ayurveda.
Hi, I'm Rekha. As Rajesh already said, I'm probably the youngest. I'm a model here.
That's great to
yeah. We are co-founders together at Sultika. We are an Ayurveda brand. We are a new age Ayurveda brand, probably redefining Ayurveda for the new generation mothers. Yes.
I am Sonic Gabriel. I run the data analytics. I'm Ashwant. I run a startup in agriculture machinery, automation.
I'm Kopu Kumar, I represent the ITF of Indian Trade Foundation and Event Management.
Okay.
I'm Nilagandan, an independent management consultant. I've been in the electrical and electronic industry space for 40 years and now I'm trying to share that to the industry.
I'm Sandeep. I'm here representing the World Trade Center Gucci.
I'm Saishni. I'm part of the startup which deals with the renewables.
Yeah, my name is Rajesh. I'm actually working with the Government of Kerala Higher Education Department. We both actually came just for networking. We have a network exchange of entrepreneurship. So we did have a great user. So just to network and get to know more about the music we came to the
excellent. Hello, my name is Shabir Mohammed, Managing Director of End Products. We are basically into special purpose machines and automations.
That's
what
CM.
Matthew Andrews, Chandler Bakhmutai, and I'm a technology automation.
Chandrasekhar, known as KC. From Tiger.
Rajesh Rai, I work with Ernst & Young. I also serve Tiger.
Thanks a lot. I think that's been a great introduction, I guess, and I think there's a lot of technology, you know. So I'll just talk to you about Bipha. It's a company. First of all, most people talk about Bipha as Bipha. So it's primarily called Bipha. It was 90. So people normally say, you know, say that's Bipha. So I say you belong to that 98% I go, which makes it wrong. It's called Bipha. It is, in fact, going from the term biological pharmaceutical. So that's how the name came. So if we trace our history back into 1929, and it all starts from this person, who's the founder, who's my grandfather. So I belong to a third generation Ayurvedic company. So, so this is the founder, Papi Varghese. So he was, in fact, he belonged to an agrarian family with about, you know, six children. All of them mostly were into agriculture. Primarily, you know, those days they would have to go to the field in the morning, do their job. That was farming in those days. But then, you know, he had a vision, and he really wanted to do something for the society. I mean, in terms of a very big social commitment he had, or social vision, I would call it. Why we start from the founder is, we still believe after 80 odd years, you know, people ask us reasons why companies sustain. I think it's not in what we do and it's not what we are. It's all about where it started and how it started and who started it, and that really is the cornerstone of the company, because this is where we actually you know, draw the whole philosophy of the company, draw the whole process and even the core principles, management principles as well, and the approach and the commitment that we bring to this business is originally derived from here. So he landed in Gurukula, and probably one of the very gifted, you know, he was blessed, one of the blessed students. They were very artists. So those days you had to stay in Gurukula, you know, live with the guru and do all the chores in the house. And, you know, that was a process when, I think, there was a time when there was no vehicles, he had to walk long distances. But then he did it. I mean, there was some divine intervention or some part, you know, that thing we have to do this. Started from Ochura, a very small, you know, village in near Karnagapalli, and then he moved out from there to Ajay, where, you know, he started, you know, this product called his blood and fracture, which we just relaunched recently. You know, see, one difference, you know, of every other Malayali family connected to Ayurveda, or you know, of every family having an Ayurvedic connection in Kerala, because our history, our traditions, our culture is so entwined with Ayurveda that we have something to do with. All of us have got something to do with Ayurveda. So essentially, but not all of them have sustained, not all of them have gone across ages to be what we can see visibly today, or what we can relate to. And there are definitely a couple of families which have come up very well, and some companies which have really made their name in the area of that. So in fact, one primary reason which I found, when I trace back to history, what I find is 1930s, and the too early for Ayurveda. Ayurveda was still unorganized, still, like, you know, where the Vaidya writes a prescription, the patient goes, plucks the, you know, the herbs from the backyard, goes, cooks the kashaya and drinks. That was the time that I'm talking about. Is when Bipha actually came out with the first proprietary formulation. We call it patent in the new age, you know, lingo. But I guess it's all about proprietary formulation. This is not traditional like in the Shimula Ashtamoda Palatina. It will be a practitioner's experience, his expertise, his knowledge, or his treatment expertise converted into a formulation. So this was done as early as 1930s. By 1940s, we had our first proprietary formulation called the blood induction. Now, tell you about innovation. Now, innovation was a term which was coined in 90s or 2000s. And that is when I really felt what was innovation, which was done ages back. Was, you know, when the company actually, there was this, I don't know whether you've all seen this product called Wincarnus. You can see it in all the duty-free shops. It's made from Scotland. And, this is a product which is based on a base of raisins. And I'm sure Matthews knows of the history of blood induction. It's made on a base. So it is given out as an iron supplement for pregnant women, something which we'd be very interested in. And this used to provide the maximum, because iron formulations are all, it tastes like iron. And it's got this whole problem of, constipation, because iron is and creates this problem, and it creates irritation, creates nausea, a lot of things, and it doesn't absorb easily. So this was one product which really provided iron, delivery of iron into especially carrying women, who always practice, iron supplementation. This is an instant success. And I still have the ads, and I've never not yet bought it out, but I'll be bringing it out soon. And it's a funny ad which says, something for Armenicum, Anicum, and somebody else. And it's a beautiful ad, and the company used to advertise much in 1930s and 40s. And I still have the advertisements, everything with me, which was quite fortunately for me. So that's where it started. It was later Nicholas sent us as blood induction laboratories, because this product was so successful and the company was known, and it's called this blood induction laboratory, with a long name. It was then divided into Beedin, something like this blood induction was large, so they made it into Beedin, then they made it into Bipha. So this was where we come from. And there's also a story of this, but I think I'll keep it for later. Neither we'll talk about that later. So 1940, Pabbi Vaidhan came into Irathaveta, then he came into Kottayam, and that was when India got independence, like 47, and then the industrialization process started, and of making everything in India. The industries minister came, because they had the industrial estate in Ichumanur, and one of the industries what we had was Bipha. They came to us, we put our first plant in Ichumanur, which is one of the first units, private sector units in the Ichumanur industrial estate. So we got this land, we got this building, we had a small, that time it was a small but good industry. But we didn't have enough to manufacture, so we didn't know what to do with the land. We had a land and we had made a good, extraordinarily good sheds. Then came the whole idea of, okay, now we have space, we have infrastructure, what do we do with it? And yes, we used to utilize it for maybe 10 days, 15 days. That's when the whole idea of pharmaceuticals came to mind. So in fact, that's when we started with pharmaceuticals. We started manufacturing all the modern formulations like paracetamol and cough syrups and everything, because that time there was a shortage. There was no big multinational companies, there were no big Indian companies. It was a beginning of pharmaceutical medicines in India, where we had the British. They used to bring all the medicines, and then we didn't have any local manufacturing. We started getting into that. So 50s to 70s, we've been very, very strong on the pharmaceutical side, because Ayurveda was at that point of time not seen very positively, because it was not seen bad, but it wasn't the main, it was not the mainstream, it was like sidelined in those ages. So that's when we started, manufacturing pharmaceutical formulations. We imported excipients, the active ingredients from Italy, where the multinational companies would bring in. We'd bring in the machinery in India, or we'd import machinery from abroad. So we brought in all that. So that was what the second generation did. The first generation started, they planted. The second generation included synchronized this with technology. And then we started manufacturing tablets, syrups, capsules, and a whole bunch of stuff. This went on till 1955 to 1970s. And then again came the second wave of innovation, where someone thought, okay, now we understood how to make tablets. Why not make Ayurveda into tablets? So this was like a wacky idea. And in 1970s, not heard of in Ayurveda. And the Kerala's Ayurvedic industry and the doctors are the most purest of them all. They like to always stick. I can see many people. If there were no Ayurvedic people here, they would have all shook heads. Because it's a very, very rigid, very controlled, very, very stipulated industry where people decide, you know, what is the right thing, what is the wrong thing, and nobody else can really come up with innovations, new ways, because it's considered as this. And then we came out with this tablets, 1970s, we came out with our first tablet for hypertension. You know, that's when we could make a tablet as good as a paracetamol tablet. We started giving it to Ayurvedic doctors, and they said, this is not mentioned in the text, and what is in the text is not this one. This is not going to work. Because kashayas, the absorption starts from the mouth, it starts from the saliva, there's a taste, there's an effect, there's a result, and there is a feel. Which is true, it's not true. But then, you know, as we pass by ages, you know, things change, we have to adapt to that. With any science that is sustained, it needs to incorporate what is happening around, put it as part of it, and then has to start evolving to a new avatar. Because otherwise, it's not going to survive. Nothing can survive. So then came this whole problem where we had made up this marvelous tablets, and then we came to doctors and they said, no, it doesn't work. We only can use the gulikas, which is used with the hands, and you know, that needs to be popped in, and that is what the Shastra says, that's what the Acharya says. There goes the story. So we started something and suddenly we have a problem. It was something good, but then it didn't work out. But they sustained, and they sustained for about 8 years, 78. Then slowly started, somebody out there felt, you know, that, you know, the tablets, you know, could be tried, tested, at least, you know, these guys have come out with something, let me try, started using it. So the tablet called, you know, this is called the MRY tablet. This is Maharasadika Shaman Yogarajagul, which used to be two formulations, but in one formulation, convenience of two products coming into one, dosage form, palatability. Started using, somebody started using, everybody started using. So 1980s, we started being known as tablet manufacturers. Then we started converting Maharasadi Kashayam as a Kashayam, so we started the first Kashaya tablet in Kerala. Took us about 8 years, 78, 79, 80s, we got accepted slowly. Even then, you know, Himalaya was there and some other North Indian companies were making tablets similar to us, so there was some amount of acceptability. 1980s, the tablet format slowly started getting accepted, and then, you know, people started using it. And Bipha, of course, was a manufacturing company, it was manufacturing, and people got to know about it, so we had distribution in about 14 districts in Kerala. And in the 80s, the product got acceptance, and suddenly another problem came up, which was shortages. And it used to take us 90 days to manufacture a formulation, and the moment the formulation comes in, the next day it's over, because people started using it that. This went on for another 5-6 years because we were always busy making the products. We were always busy in the manufacturing floor, and the product comes in and it goes off. So this used to be known as, you know, bypass products, but you never get it. Okay, so that went on. But for us, it was good because what we manufactured used to be sold. And we didn't have to spend everything on sales. We had distributors who just pick up everything we were doing. So that is how it went, and then immediately a couple of years passed. We still were battling hard because we had financial, you know, working capital issues, and other things. We nobody was there to take care of finances, so there was like. But we still did what we did, and then came the normal Kerala entrepreneurship model. Then there's a shortage. Let me make something similar. This is entrepreneurship. Where there's a gap, where there's a need, you need to go in. Other companies started looking at it. They started picking up stuff. They said, Bipha is going to close down, they're not having enough product, and we're getting the same guys from Bipha to manufacture this product here, and this is going to be there, this is not going to be there. Wow. So that was the time when I came into the business, where we had products, and we had demand, we didn't have supply, and we had some new guys who were making money, you know. They said, they're selling a similar name product, and they used to substitute, they used to say all this nonsense, and you know, we're losing business. I mean, at least we're not losing business, we were losing share. Okay, that's when I came in, and that's the time when I came in, you know, where the business was small. We were working from a 600 square feet store, which I would say the open dusty store, where I mean, that's where my grandfather used to practice. I had a, you know, and then there were people around me who were exporting to Netherlands and others, and a lot of people asked me, you know, Ayurveda is not great, you know, are you exporting? So we used to export to Muscat in containers from 76 to 80s. But then they changed regulation, they stopped. So we had zero exports, but everybody knew us. Everybody knew us as a company. Everybody knew us about the great product. And the next question is, well, are you not exporting? And then I said, no. Yes, I said, we had to be exporting because we had to put up a good face. And they said, yes, we are exporting. And, you know, but then we were not exporting at all. That's when two challenges, domestic price substitutions happening, competition getting in. No export market, but you know, you see, you know, third-party guys who had nothing to do with either exporting in big numbers, and suddenly people ask, you know, I mean, the whole idea was, you know, hey, idiots, you know, what are you doing here? You know, you have a fabulous product, you're selling Ayurveda, you're not exporting, and everybody else is doing it. It's like a big threat, you know, you have something and you're not doing it, it's like your fault, I mean, it's your job, you're responsible. Then started, that's when, you know, if you really look at entrepreneurship, it throws up challenges, it throws up problems, and then it also throws up opportunities. Then we started looking at the market, we started improving, you know, having presence across the state, across 40 districts in Kerala. And then we started traveling into international markets where my first, the only news I had was one person whom I knew was exporting to the Netherlands. Okay. Took my bag, went into the Netherlands, got into an exhibition, and here I'm there, wanted the exports. Didn't know anything about anything, just went and landed, took a stall, and then we had a small stall, one desk stall. We didn't have anything, we didn't know how to do anything. We got hold of a designer, made a small, you know, like I don't know, in the old Murkangaras, you had that small box. I don't know if you all remember. They used to put everything in the glass pot on top of a box. We had something similar, but something very well designed, very well designed. We had some glass, soda, you know, what in a bar, they would serve sodas. It is open. We made some wooden caps, we put our oils in, we made a nice brand. We went in, me and my brother. So both of us were there in the Netherlands exhibition, standing tall, and then were the Dabbers and the Best of Indian industry was there. But one thing I learned, I mean, which we didn't know, was primarily that what we had was small, but it was beautiful. Because we had a lot of guys coming in and said, where do you design? And where do you do the business? And you know, what do you have? And suddenly we said, so my whole thing is, I only talk to the white skins. Those are the people whom I expected had the money and, you know, had this good throw. So my brother's job is to see everybody else. So, you know, we started doing this process, and then, you know, my brother said, you know, just look at this guy, the same guy, saying he's very interested, you know, big guy. And then he gave it to me, and then I talked to this gentleman, very seasoned guy, stopped him for about 45 minutes, gave me his card to the CEO of Dabur, so Mr. Duba. So, you know, kind of guys, you came to your small store, you know, where you started talking about you and your product, and, you know, you were getting attention. But honestly speaking, I didn't get any business there. I met with a lot of people, came back. And then went on for several exhibitions more. Once you lose, you have to keep fighting. So I kept on fighting because you didn't have a choice. You have only one choice, either to win or you fail, you know, or you say that you failed in the business. So I fortunately, I was mentored by my uncle. You know, I was talking to somebody and I was riding down for a podium. I said, one thing about my uncle was, you know, he'd always send me for any exhibition and say, how was it? And you know, he'll tell me, you know, the moment I said I have to go to the Netherlands, he'd say, okay. How much is the fee? What is the cost? When will you go? When will you come? What are your plans? Okay, I tell him all this. And I said, okay, fine, sir. And the moment I come back, then I have to debrief him about what happened, whom I met, how many people do I met, what business do I expect. And always he ends up with one question. So when are you going to get an order? I said, it's going to come. I'm going to write and we're going to get it. And there's somebody who's very, very prospective, we'll get it. And he's asked me for this. There's a big business coming in. Sure thought, you know, that I'm going to get it. I don't know where, but I had the whole feeling. So I'll never say, you know, that I won't get it. We'll have to go once again. But then the fun part, I mean, when I look back today, it was like he'd always encouraged me, never asked me a question, you know, how much money did you spend and what did you get? He never asked me that. He just asked me, what is next? When are you going to get? What is your next plan? So this went on from 2000 to about 2008. When I started, then my first order I got was $2,000, but I was very excited from Nigeria. There's only one order which I got, was super excited. That was the time of fax, and that was the time I had to run for a fax, to receive a fax, to send a fax. I was like all the while excited to do all these things. And that was from a small office where I had only a dial-up computer and a dial-up connection and a computer. But I only had one secretary, who was my typist, who was my secretary, who was my sales coordinator, who was my back-end of every operation. In the interim, I went in and launched a brand called the Servionics. I walked into Health and Glow and said, you know, I have this fabulous range Ayurveda, then I want to launch. And I single-handedly went from Kerala all the way to Pune, went to Hyderabad, went to Bangalore, went to Chennai, launched a brand.
Nothing. I didn't have a marketing manager, I didn't have a logistics manager, I didn't have anything. I had this whole thought that there is a brand, there's a beautiful brand, which is very done, very artistic. So the fact is, I went and launched across 4 states. Single man, he'll go, he'll launch, he'll train, he'll place people, come back into Canada, get out, and then look for the orders. So this was what, that was me. That was how I used to do things. I didn't have anything else. So waited for about 6 months. I used to start getting orders of thousands of them. But then my expectations were very high. I wanted to do a couple of lakhs in a few months. I was not getting it. So I got very frustrated. And after 6 months, 1 year, I said, oh, this is too much. I can't handle it. So I said, uncle, it doesn't seem that it's working out. So let me shut down this. And what's the cost? He said, it was a couple of lakhs that time. So I said, fine, forget it. I'll make it out somehow. But he never said, why did you do this? Why are you stopping? Nothing. And he just left it there. This also gives you responsibility, because when you fail, when you are allowed to fail, when you are responsible and you also become accountable, that's when I started working very hard, got into a few markets in Malaysia, and bagged the biggest order, which is about 55 lakhs in 2008. We tied up with one of the largest pharmaceutical companies called Formula, and we got it. We launched a brand called Xenoho. Then came the meltdown, the recession of 2018. We were exporting very well into Europe, because all this travel, I used to meet people and I used to call them every now and then, patiently asking how the weather, how things there. It took me two years to develop the first client in Europe. It was again a letter which came in 1986, which I saw in a file. So after this Netherlands, I'll tell you about that. So the Netherlands, we came into Italy for about 10. So we were in Milan, so we went into Milan and went into this, meet this guy. Small store, old person. I was like crestfallen, oh my God, is it all gone? No, nothing happened. But he in fact recommended me to meet another guy who was one of the largest distributors for Himalayan in Italy. So that's when we met him. I could only meet him for half an hour, and then we met him. It took me 2 hours to first develop my first big client in Europe. He still is one of my largest clients and good friends also. But it took me two years. I mean, so nothing happens by magic, everything happens over time. Everything happens with patience, everything happens with consistent patience. So this is something which I learned there. And Malaysia, we did a very large deal in 2008. But then Europe, we exported to about eight countries. Then regulations changed, the recession struck, export came down. But of course, we were doing quite well on the domestic front. We were very, very strong. We were quite dominant in our sector. Launched a whole lot of new products. Strengthened the company's network into Tamil Nadu, Karnataka. So we started growing. Then came the next wave of, I would say, entrepreneurship comes by waves, or it's like every wave which hits you. So that came. So I traveled a lot. I traveled about 20 countries by then. I went into all the delegations of PharmExil. I went into whichever country, Uganda, Tanzania, wherever. I mean, wherever anybody goes, I'll always be on the delegation. I'll go on a CIA delegation to Sri Lanka. But everything taught me something. Everything gave me something. If you ask me, it would be 20, 25 travel or maybe 40 trips, but then everything added on to what I learned. I used to go see how things were sold. I used to go see how things were labeled, what were there, what was not there, what was the price and all that. Then 2010, suddenly another new idea came up. We had a lot of lifestyle products for cholesterol, for diabetes, for hypertension. When I look at my figure, they all talk about, India being the diabetes capital, Kerala being the capital of India for diabetes and all that. But if you look at the numbers in Ayurveda, it was never so great. It was always a few thousand. So if you look at the numbers, it never equates each other. I used to keep asking my sales manager and all that, why does it not happen? I used to be on them, after them, but doesn't make much of a good added by another 1,000 or 2,000. That's when I started understanding. See, Ayurveda is traditional science. It is doing great. People know it. We feel that it is part of us. We own it. We have some relativity and connections to it. But then the problem was, in fact, it was also a period of transition. India realized in 1991. We're talking about an India which was much younger. And of course, they do respect Ayurveda. They've heard about Ayurveda. They've used Ayurveda. But it's not part of their lifestyles anymore. It is, Ayurveda was not in. It's not great. It is not hip or whatever it is. So that's when the whole thought of, how do you connect? Okay. Again, got back into the journey. You know, then it's just like, for some time it's like a big chase. It's like wild goose chase, go. And when I go to Cochin Airport, I said, I want a store. Wow. So there was this young guy who was younger than me, a very, very sharp guy, an engineer. He was handling the commercial side of Cochin Airport. He was curious and he was amused. And I'm sure that he would not believe me when I went to talk to him first. And he said, yeah, Ayurveda, because it was not known. And then, we went on, came out with a tender, nobody else applied, so leave me. So I just went and quoted 25,000 rupees for this. That was all what I can say. That was big money for me now, then now, because I was paying maximum back of 6,000 rupees, I went in 25,000 rupees. Somehow they negotiated, they said, you can't leave at 60,000 rupees. I said, I can't pay you 60,000 rupees, even if I put my company, it won't come. And you know, I started cribbing as a typical, you know, businessman who doesn't know anything but has an idea. So I went and said, sir, no, sir, I can't. Finally, we agreed on 48,000 and I got a allotment letter saying that. So I didn't know what was security, what I didn't know what was pre-security, what I didn't know anything about the store. But this guy somehow got a feel, okay, this guy's it's an idiot, but then, you know, he has something to, something in him that, you know, makes me feel convinced that, okay, I should go and try out his life. So finally, they agreed and they gave me a store. So I was really excited, but the only problem is I didn't know how to build a store. I didn't have any clue about anything. I got a store. I didn't know, I didn't have an architect, I didn't have any know-how, you know. It was just a store of paper that says you have to start a bit of these things. And I have in fact, by the time, booked into a Ukraine trip where I had to go. And then I found a friend of mine who was almost closing up a startup. So he was like not very engaged, and then he was very, very close. He was my junior. I gave him this thing and said, well, I have a problem, you know, would you help me? He said, don't worry, you go to Ukraine, I'll see that it is done. So I said, fine, we agree on a fee. And he got it, he took it, he got the design. Even then, Cochin Airport wasn't very convinced we'll come out with a good design, because, you know, typically Ayurvedic stores are predictable. It's brown, it's at a corner of any town, it'll be dusty, it'll have that bad packaging, big bottles, rusted place, not painted, bad goods. So this is what probably would have expected. Somehow we ended up doing a store. And still they were not convinced how the store will come up. You know, then it's a question of implementing and constructing the store. And the question is what product? So we had this product which we took to Netherlands, which is called as Atma, which is with a nice, you know, this Nelappa kind of design. And we had this Herbie on it. So we started with 40 products. We came back, the store was ready to start, and there was a lot of legal hurdles, maybe, but we started on time. First day we inaugurated, and we did 8,000 rupees of sales, and we were very happy. But honestly, I always tell, on my way back home, I said, you know, this is going to be the next foolish failure that I'm going to do. I'm not going to ever make money. 3 months later, my finance guy would say, you know, boss, more money to be pumped in. Do you think it's a great idea? Should we shut down? Because, you know, typical Kerala attitude is, you know, shutting down is like very, very happy, very, you know, everybody loves to talk about it. Especially your employees would like to always say, that idea didn't fail. You know, why don't we close it down? Why don't we wind it up? Because everybody wants to be in the comforts of no risk taking, where, you know, everything's predictable, no? That money of a lakh will come, I'll get 5,000 rupees, and this is like what they want. So I would like I would say, you know, the guy who would always like to come out with some disruptive stuff, something, you know, I would like, I'm always on to something, and I'll never stop at anything and we'll keep doing it. So I said, okay, this is going to be the next episode, how Bionics was going on, that export isn't working. Okay, then I went back. But fortunately, my friend who was with me, who was also very good in operationalizing the process, and put everything in place, put my systems in place, and we started. And believe me, from the first month, it was a new business, but we had enough money to pay rent to the staff and to the suppliers. I would say it met with reasonable, good amount of acceptance. Not that it was great, not that there was anything too great about it, probably it was something which has worked, that's all. As typically entrepreneur models, then we took out what we learned, and then we immediately went with a few other airports. I would not believe, you know, the second airport where we went was Singapore. A Changi gave me a letter that says, I've been alerted in the space at the landslide of the Changi airport. My God, it was unimaginable, but I still went to Changi, and they were about to give me, then I finally thought, you know, it would be difficult for me. So I didn't take up the store. It's on the landslide of the Singapore airport. Then came to Trivandrum, we started our second store in Trivandrum, which was good because by the time we learned a few more things. Went into Cochin again for the domestic store, where we were the highest bidders. We almost spent about 2.5 times more than what we paid. That is when we started Coimbatore. We started 4 stores. Then was 7 stores, which included, that is typical Bipha style, we went in from Kerala right into Mumbai and to Udaipur and to Ahmedabad. We don't even know where these places were, but then we got place, we took it, we started it. And then came the problem, you know, managing 11 stores wasn't easy. Because 4 was easy, 4 was profitable, 7 was tough, and 7 was not profitable. People, culture, a lot of things which we never learned, which we never understood, which we never thought was a threat, started becoming a larger threat, started eating into our operational margins. We went up to 14 stores again because we had to consolidate with the mistakes which we made. And then we learned over the last couple of years about where we were going wrong. It was basically in staffing, basically in people, in people metrics and people resources. Corrected it now. Worked up a lot on the products because it was an entire new experience. Retail was an entire new experience. You know, it was a different animal. It was not manufacturing, it was not marketing, it was not anything, it was a different animal. Which was about customers, which is about consumers, which are like dictators who decide what they want, when they want, how they want, and what should be delivered. So this was a big learning process in a B2B company who was used to waiting, making customers wait for weeks to deliver products to someone, a company which has to be very responsive, very sensitive, very much on the toes to please customers, to see that every small answer, every small question is answered on time, answered right. So it was a big process of learning to convert, to change the attitude of the whole company, which is a challenge because from 1 to 14 in 4 years wasn't great, it wasn't easy. Then was the next 2 years where we corrected, we closed down a few of the unprofitable stores, which we learned because I think those are things which we have learned. And we have corrected all our number of products, went up to 190. Innovation and ideation was up in the air, products were like made out of thin air, packaging was changed and it was constantly improved and improvised. New formats, new thoughts, new segments. We are now dealing with 7 segments, 190 products, with a footprint in about 9 cities, with 11 stores today. We've closed down 3. Currently, when I'm sitting here, we are going to implement another 7 stores and 17 stores. And by March, we'll have 20 stores. Maybe it will become 24 stores. So here is where you would see what we learn. Because end of the day, where we started, we didn't have anything other than that entrepreneurial fire which makes you believe that anything is possible and everything is possible. The readiness to fail and to face challenges and the readiness to fail, you know, which was not failure, honestly. If I look back, I didn't think Avionics wasn't a failure. Avionics would have been a big success today for the company, would have been $1 million deal. But all helped for something else which came later. The travel which we made, the first trip into Netherlands gave us this brand, Atma, which we could first put in the shelves. So all that, if you really look at it all falls in place as a strategical growth plan. So we always today believe, we say, everything in Bipha happens as a strategy, but it will be very sporadic and very erratic. But if you put the puzzles back, it will all fall in place to say that this is a global strategy. So this is a strategy which is company thing. Believe me, it's not coming out of any big research reports. No, nothing. It's based purely on an entrepreneurial spirit to, you know, which keeps us making forward. But of course, I'm not trying to say that anything happened out of magic, anything happened because it was there. It all happened out of plan, out of process, out of drive, out of problems, out of challenges, out of anything what we faced. But yes, today we have a very good base of customers who would. Yesterday I was at an Economic Times trial. Interview. You know, we had a panelist. And the panelist was saying, you know, hey, I'm using a product, you know, Bipha product, and there was audience. You know, like it's like an award. It's like an award winning every day. And you know, I was at an award function of Destination Kerala. I had an awardee who said, hey, I'm a big fan of Bipha. I said, please, this is big. It's much larger than this award because to get a customer to talk, to tell, to recommend you is like amazing. It's an out of the world experience where you would do anything that is possible in this world to see that he or she is taken care of. The last time I was in Delhi, we were in an expo. Suddenly a lady came running and, hey, Bipha, you're here. We are very happy. You know, I saw your products there and, you know, you're here. I'm so excited. And she said, you know, I'm working for Philippines Embassy. And it so happens that because she was ambassador of Philippines. I said, when are you coming to Delhi? And I said, ma'am, it's my fault. I'm going to be in Delhi. Yes, I signed up for Delhi yesterday, one of the best malls in Delhi. Because I feel that this is where you need to go. You should not be where you are. You should not be waiting for anybody to come to you. You should go out there and put your stuff, put your wear, and be bold enough to do that. You know, you'll fail. Right? That's the worst thing that can happen, right? Nothing else, right? If you fail, what do you do? I mean, you learn. You come out, you know, there is nothing called as failure. I mean, it's all from that box which you make, which may have to be modified. It may need a better size, it may need a new packaging, it may need something new, that's it. Or you are in a wrong market, you are in a wrong location, that's all. But you still had something which was different, which was made for something, which can be used for something else. So, what I'm trying to say is, this is an entrepreneurial journey, where, you know, today we're talking about 24, and the first international store is coming in Malaysia on probably the first quarter of 2018. Today, on the export market, we are all completely different a company. We don't anymore sell products, and we don't neither want any buyers. That's a new philosophy in our company. We say that we don't sell any more products, we want only people to buy, and we want only partners. We don't want anybody to import, anybody to distribute. First thing we do is, every country we go in, the strategy is ours, the plan is ours, we roll up. We are the brand, we are the engine, you just be there. You invest money, you'll make sure that you make your money back. So the entire process of how we're approaching is changing. And the entire way in which we are today, we're not anymore excited about customers, we're excited about how the customer is going to sell. What is it that they're going to do with our product? What is the format they plan? And we manage everything for them. So it's primarily today moving more towards a solution-based, revenue-based model where, you know, somebody's partnering you. It's not anymore that, you know, please put in money into my business and then you make profit. No, you don't make any profit unless I'm ready to partner you. The moment I partner you, yes, I've got a model which gives me money, I can customize it to your market, tell you what to do right, and let's do that. So today, that way we are, in fact, we've grown into many more than 50 now. Actually, we're going into the Middle East in a bigger way. We're starting up in Malaysia by March, and we're getting into Sri Lanka, we're getting into Qatar, we've registered products, Kuwait, Dubai, Bahrain, one of our CMs in the last icon just put me on to two partners, and that's a time network, you get in no time where you need to reach. And Bahrain is coming up, so that's how fast things are moving. And of course, I didn't tell you about how we're moving digital. So the plans forward are, we've also in between started a hospital in Kottayam. One of the oldest hospitals in Kottayam, I was sitting on a Saturday after Sunday after church, I was sitting. So my neighbor was passing by. She said, "Hey, do you know that, you know, this hospital is leased, like lessee has left it, and it's not for rent." Okay, this was a Sunday. I got a proposal. I made a proposal on Monday. Wednesday, I had a hospital with me. A 27,000 square feet hospital. Didn't know any clue about how to run it, with an anesthetic, you know, everything in it. You know, an operation theater, a doctor, everything, you know, pharmacy, everything, X-ray. Then, yeah, I did a little bit of running the hospital, then I understood, you know, electric hospital is not my cup of tea. So, you know, I said, it's a different business, which I don't want to do, because I've always done businesses where, you know, we have served happy people. You know, where, you know, our mission says spreading health and happiness. So I didn't want to make misery out of money, and money out of misery. So we wound up the electric side, we still run that hospital. It's been 6 years, it's doing quite well, and again, why I said about this is, you know, it's not been, you know, initially it was not a great time to live, but there's a lot of learning. It's now giving way to the new model of Bipha into services. It's not yet launched, but the design is even ready. We would possibly launch it abroad. So everything what we do, that's what I'm saying, is it's all being connected to something in the future which is falling as part of the strategy. The whole core of this company is moving towards Ayurveda, and everything what does is going to be Ayurveda. So this is what the whole philosophy is moving. 5 years, 10 years down the line, I hope we would like to see ourselves in a digital company, and that's where we're moving into. So we are using a lot more technology today. We feel technology is the future for any industry. So it's how you can utilize technology. Anybody can use technology to enable growth. And good thing today is the cloud is making everything cheap, and an app is making everything accessible. So there are a whole lot of new ways that we can really grow. And I feel that there's a whole lot of new opportunities that are coming up into any industry, be it rubber, be it spices, be it anything you can imagine, you have a whole big opportunity is what I feel. And whenever I travel, you know, I talk a lot about coconut oil, you know, I say,
Even I do that. You know, I said, the moment I see coconut, coconut oil is today a big, big health food internationally. Would you believe it? I was like shattered when I saw in Durban, in UK, in Istanbul, companies selling health, you know, oil as coconut oil as health supplement, and that was all imported from Thailand. That was all imported from Sri Lanka, done by some company in Korea, imported by some company, marketed by some company in UK, sold in across the world in tons.
Virgin.
It's virgin on, you know, it's not anymore what it is. It is all about, like, you know, you say the word organic, people buy, you know, kind of stuff. You know, it's like a serious thing. People are started suddenly consuming, they want, and it's big. Now, how many Kerala companies, I'm just saying, because it's become my, you know, kind of responsibility that, you know, whenever I say coconut oil, I said it's going to definitely come from Kerala. And I even went up to the extent of picking a brand of the coconut, and you know, we are the pros. I think every Kerala must have to start thinking about it. Because I said, the very name of my state is Kerala, which is land of coconuts, and if it doesn't come from there, where could it come from? And the whole world is selling coconuts, the whole world is, you know, consuming coconuts. Why are we not able to sell? The coconut water is a big opportunity. You know, spices. I was in Kuwait now, I'm getting a friend of mine, you know, they're one of the biggest spice, you know. I said, get me your spice, let me sell it in Kuwait. See, the point is not about anymore making money. It is all about you're representing a land, you're representing a space, which has got so much to offer to the world. It used to traditionally offer so much to the world. Why are we not able to do it now? And we're always like, you know, you always want to supply it to somebody in a big way, no? You have to make your own inroads with what we have and try and establish that. And I feel that Kerala in that way has a lot of opportunity, and we've got a lot of young, talented, you know, intelligent people in Kerala who are very good. I mean, who've gone all across the world, you know, working and doing good in every company, can also take the state forward to a different level. So I feel, why I thought I would like to share all this is because huge opportunities exist. We talk about recession today, right? What is a recession about? What is recession? Recession, everybody says, you know, it's a time when things don't work, you know, things don't happen. I think, believe me, I think everything is working everywhere. And people who are making money are making money. If not, we'll still talk about recession. And I think the world is a great place to really work because it's so full of opportunities. The only thing is, you have to be there to grab it. You have to be there to really, take that moment in that warp of time. You know, this is what it is all about. It is not about waiting for somebody to come, waiting for that opportunity to strike and knock and say, hey, there's an opportunity. You'll be like, no, you need to be after it. And that's what makes it very exciting, and that's what makes it exciting. You know, I would say it's something very exciting for us to all look forward to. So I feel I'll just quickly take you to our products and packaging, because again, I've only told you about one side of what we did. There are a lot of things which go behind it. Making a brand is not an easy thing because it's like nurturing a child. So it's as critical, as sensitive, as careful a process. But today we're transforming to think like a brand. And of course, we today think about, we don't anymore think like a company, we don't anymore think like a product, we think like a brand. And we think of every product as a brand ambassador. So it's like every product has a story, every product has to be known, and every product has a reason why it should be sold. No product can sell without a story. And every product you ask me, I can tell you a story why it should be sold. And we again feel that we are today doing more than selling or promoting Ayurveda. We think we now have reframed it by saying that we are selling the essence of a land. An essence of a land where, you know, now we've come out with a series called Ravi Varma series, where we are celebrating the great Kerala artist Ravi Varma. We're coming out with a pack now which celebrates the mural art of Kerala. So we are now getting to be a brand which we would like to be very distinctively, you know, connected to Kerala. Because that's where I said I would like to be what I am, you know, rather than like to be a foreigner. You know, I'd like to be a Kerala brand to the world. I'd like to bring in all the elements of Kerala. Now we are working on our uniforms to make it very much like Kerala. So I'd like to be in Mumbai, I would representing Kerala. I'd like to be in Berlin, I'd like to be in any place where I'd like to represent my land. I don't want to be saying, you know, I'm from another place, because this land is the best land, you know, it's a blessed, you know, because the moment you travel out, you know, people say, you know, you're blessed, you know, because you're in a beautiful green place. But, you know, ask a typical Keralaite, will never say so. So much is there in this land that we can all, because, you know, this is marketing, this is promotion, this is branding. And what else can you have than selling every bit of this land by showcasing every bit of land? So this is just thoughts which I thought I'd like to share, because we are also here looking for opportunity, thinking about opportunity, thinking about what's the next big idea. But I think there are enough and more ideas around us, enough and more opportunities around us. It's just the way you look at it. It is just the way you see it, and it's just the way you like to take it forward. And that's all about it. Don't, because there's nothing wrong. There's no right way, there's no wrong way. Every way is the right way, provided you're willing to iterate your way to where you need to go. I'll just show you a few slides, just to give you a brief of what, you know, how the products look like. We have an academy, which trains students for Ayurvedic therapies. So today, if you look at us, we have grown from a product company which was only selling products, which was used by doctors, which was a very personalized process of selling, to a very consumer-oriented process where the customer is at the core of the company. And we think of everything from a customer perspective than from our perspective, from any other perspective. So this is what we do. So we've also started an academy. Now we can offer solutions to set up centers. We're like a turnkey partner to anybody. So if you have to do something with Ayurveda, the whole proposition or promise that we make is leave it to us. You just have to do the front part of running it, the rest comes from us. So that's how we move forward. This is primarily the store, the shelves of how the Bombay Airport store looks like. This is the different categories we have. They've evolved a lot. The latest what we brought in is spices, organic spices, which are organically certified. We have a huge range of traditional products, health and wellness, personal care, bath and body. It's 190 products in 7 years. This is the store in Hyderabad Airport. The store in Mumbai Airport. Now today we got another store in Mumbai Domestic Terminal. And I would not like to shock you with the rentals, but I would just tell you that it goes into multiples of what you usually pay in. Not small multiples, big multiples of what you pay in Churcha Network. You'll shatter. But the good thing is, I can also go ahead and start the one in the Fifth Avenue. It will be still cheaper. It's crazy, yeah? India is getting crazy pricey, but then that's India. Because the kind of volumes India gets, I don't think India will do so. That's what we're talking here today. And the way Indians buy, you not believe. I don't anymore now. One, change in perspective. 2000, I believe that, you know, everybody who's a foreigner is the biggest customer. Now today, I don't even talk to foreigners. And Indian is 10 times a better customer than ever. And the way Indians buy, you can't imagine. Nothing is called as expensive and nothing is called as price today. Price is what people determine. And that's what it is all about. And they don't care how much you charge. And it's all about what you deliver. If you deliver right, they're willing to spend. And if you go wrong on one element, you're gone. They'll dice you. But that's India. That's a beautiful, you know, exciting time for us to be in India. This is the last store. This is the latest store, not the last store. The latest store in Calcutta Airport. If you look at it, we work on formats. The first stores are the first version 1 of design. This is version 3 of design. We evolved. Everything about us evolves. The packaging evolves, the change, the thought evolves. The core principles never change. The tradition never change. For example, some of our products, our oils are you know, like 3 times, 4 times more expensive than the market. But then we say it's like wine. It's like fine wine. You can't make out the difference unless you, but then you know that there's a difference. But then this all comes out of the process. It all comes out of what goes in. And even today, our oils are made in a bronze vessel wood fire. This is the element we still, we modernized a lot, we modernized everything. We modernized on our outside, we modernized on our communication, our conversation, the way we are put. But heart of heart, we're still a very, very traditional Ayurvedic company. It still follows the principles of Ayurveda very meticulously. I'm not saying because this is a well-preserved part of Bipha and we are not touching it at all. We're not modernizing it. We don't want to modernize it. And we feel that this is the biggest point of value. On the other side, we are going the most modern methodology is what a customer would need today. So this is the contradiction in Bipha which we balance, right? Because this is the way which we would like to take Ayurveda responsibly and to the masses in a right format which is acceptable to people. So this is the store at Churcha Airport. We have about 4 stores now. This is a new store in Subang Airport in Malaysia. This will be our first international store.
the store in store format that we've started. It's a concept. It's a kiosk that we're developing now. We're going into many more places, so we'll have to adapt to format. So if you really look at it, you can see how we evolve. So we are not the brand which says, this is what we are. We would like to be what we could be in places, but we will not change our format. We'll change our format, but the basic elements of design. So it's the new modules which have not been launched, but we are working on them. This is how our products looks like. These are health supplements. This is the herbionics which I talked about. This was an invention of 2002. This is how all this packaging has changed now. This is our version 2 of packaging. Now the version 3 of packaging has come in. Now none of these products, now you don't see this. I mean, this packaging is almost getting over. New packaging is coming in. If you look at the difference between this packaging and the new packaging, you know the difference. It's a marvelous new design, a marvelous new approach. So that's what we constantly come out with, new innovations. These are all like non-sticky oils, which are natural, 100% natural, not paraffin based. And it's an SLS free wash. These are the cold pressed oils. We have the coconut oil also. This is the most expensive kungumani you can find in India. It's tenable, it costs you 2,450. Still, we could purchase it because if your quality is inside the bottle. The cheapest is 60 rupees. These are the candles that we've started on. This was version 1, now this whole packaging has changed. These are the gift packs, which are called the Navarasa packs, which are all handmade. It takes about 21 days for us to manufacture our soap. We say it's a soap, it's a soap completely made without electricity. It's hand polished, hand cut, and it's a very, very delicate process which we took 2 years to 3 years to make, to master. This is the Ravi Burma series. We've got about 6 series. So where we would like to celebrate the art. Because you know Kerala is all about Ravi Burma, but we don't talk about him. So we'll have to celebrate his works. A lot of people know him, but they don't know his works. These are our Christmas packs, which is now running in the stores. These are the Diwali packs, which we made for Diwali in the north of India. This is about our hospital. So that pretty much winds up what I wanted to say. I don't know whether I have given you a clear story, but this is what I know. Anything else, you can probably ask us questions, and I'm not sure what all new areas or other areas which I missed out. But this is my story. Thank you.
Great for TV and then.
So I'd like to know really, any kind of question on anything to do with Ayurveda or anything like what I know.
No, what?
Except you know how to grow hair. Typical questions I said, it's already known. So I have an answer, so don't worry.
You don't have medicines for growing hair.
No, I'll give you one. Don't worry. I had another very interesting question yesterday which I had answered. Somebody wanted to know, who consumes a lot of garcinia wants to know, what garcinia does to weight the gut. So that is a televised interview.
Garcinia.
Garcinia is essentially a product which is nothing but cottonwood. It's an extract of cottonwood. So it's primarily something which is selling hot in the international market for reduction of weight. It's a weight management process. It's not like you consume garcinia and you weigh it. This is what people want. Everybody wants magic out of the bottle, which doesn't exist. If you really look at
right on.
The best thing is consume cottonwood. That's a basic thing. But what is happening is you don't anymore use cottonwood. You don't use the cottonwood in our study or whatever.
Those
are
fish,
right? Yeah, those are fish. So what is happening is if you look at turmeric today, it is one of the hottest selling supplements in the US today. Yeah. Simple, plain old turmeric, what we use here, and that all goes to Kerala. Remember. And don't ask me what it is. It's so much of research on it, on cancer, and it's one of the hottest selling supplements in the US. And there are a lot many more that is going from the state, not out of the state. What we used to consume is all becoming big. Okay, coconut oil is one. Moringa is now becoming the third one. So anything that we have consumed is what is selling. So
this was a question. So I said, I mean, it's essentially, these are all things which we used to consume as part of our lifestyle, part of our cuisine, but now we don't anymore consume. So it's just supplementation now. Don't say, you know, how much of Brahmi if I consume, how much memory will increase. You want to, you know, improve your memory, keep consuming Brahmi, it has a positive effect. Okay, shoot out. Good question.
Ajay, you have an R&D, very strong R&D, and you're coming up appropriately. So what is the situation of patency law in Kerala per se?
You talk about the manufacturing side, or you talk about the patent as an
patent?
Patent as
taking patents for proprietary medicines or oils.
Okay. It's quite difficult because patent law is essentially, patents are given essentially to something which is innovative, novel, and not previously known. So if you're talking about a formulation, for example, what happens is there will be prior information, prior knowledge of it, even if it's a combination. Like you say a balatailam, I'm going to put a balatailam and dhanvantaram and talk about it being a patent. People say the application is known. But for example, now you take any herb. Take turmeric and say turmeric is good for leprosy or some other, you know, maybe for dengue, which is not a known application. You can take that application. So you can actually.
So we have dhanvantaram and balatailam together, you won't get a patent.
You can't take a patent. Because the point is the application of, unless. Now, if you can come out with saying that, okay, balatailam, just for example, not balatailam, any oil, you are going to find that if you consume it internally, it is good to improve immunity, which was not known earlier, it can be patented. So that application of that particular product can be patented.
So, but can you manufacture the other ones itself? What are the rules regarding that? The mixing of dhanvantaram and balatailam. Can you do it together and sell it? And what are the rules regarding
Absolutely. That's a good question. I mean, that you know, the fun part about Kerala is now the only state in India which is not issuing any new proprietary patent.
Exactly.
That's unfortunate.
I think even Tamil Nadu is finding it very difficult nowadays.
Yeah, that is, see, because that's where our government start modernizing itself, and you know, they start understanding what is Ayurveda, what is modern, and they want to say, we are improving, we are, you know, we are regulating, and you know, we want to be like what the Western world is. I mean, we're going the wrong way. Government think, you know, by regulating more and more, you're going to be standardized. And it is not that way. You need very balanced regulation, you know, which would help industry to flourish and also the public interest to be taken. So what is happening now? They apply the same level of clinical trial for you know, Ayurveda. So any new product which you're going to bring in, which is a new combination, can only be done after doing a clinical trial. And that is done only in 3 Ayurveda colleges in Kerala. And this 3 Ayurveda college does not have any research facility other than Kottayam. So you go there, you put your product there, and they do a testing. Now, for example, our latest product, which is waiting regulatory approval, is for a product which has got a patent. It's a patented product, which is a patent as a real patent. For a product, it's a combination product for HPV virus. Okay? Now, HPV virus is a key causative factor for cervical cancer. Okay? In India, 70% of the women are carriers of HPV virus. And this ultimately converts into a cervical cancer. Patented product with a lot of even international patents pending. We have, in fact, now we have put in the application for this product, and it is not going through because the drugs department said, you know, it has to be done. The trial for an HPV virus has to be done in an Ayurvedic college in Kerala. So it's going to happen. It's not going to happen at all. Now we're going through a process where we're getting the government of India, because there is no product or no effective formulation for controlling HPV virus. And it is, even in cases of cervical cancer, it can actually reduce, you know, reduce the effects of, and it's a herbal combination. It's wonderful. It's even done, the clinical tests are done in AIDS. The Kerala government says, now go to the Ayurveda college where there is no cancer patient who's going to come. And they don't even, they definitely know what is HPV virus, but the point is, no, who's going to go with a viral infection to a government hospital? So that's where, you know, sometimes rules are a big impediment to.
So what is an opportunity to get your patents in India, which other states are behind the data?
Go to Gujarat.
Maharashtra.
Any place. Other than any liberal state will give you anything what you want. Kerala is stricter to rules and they stick to rules. I mean, not that others don't, but they take a liberal view of it. the question is, what is approach? See, the question is, you know, our rules are today framed in a manner where there is no black and white. You know, there is a gray, and a gray is determined by somebody. So it all depends on what color it appears to the person who decides. A law is interpretable. So somebody was asking me about ease of doing business yesterday. The Kerala government, we were asking like, what is your, you know, your recommendation to make Kerala, you know, more, how to improve the ease of doing business in Kerala? I said, three things. One, give respect to time. Make everything online. Two, go for a deemed license where, you know, I comply with what you say. If I don't follow, I will have to pay a penalty or whatever. That's my responsibility. Make everything electronic. Two is, make it black and white. Give me a procedure which I can follow, rather than, you know, telling me different things which I can't follow. So end of the day, you have to do things in a manner. See, one easy way is, go out into other states where things work. Okay, things work. I'm not saying anybody breaks the rule, but then there is always a procedure which is much easier than Kerala, where things happen. So unfortunately, for the last few years now, we are in fact one of the companies which has the largest number of patented products in Kerala. We've got 240 plus licensed formulations in the which we have not even opened up to the world. I mean, there are a lot of formulations which goes international, which is not even launched in Kerala. We have not been doing much except these very large formulations which have got a huge market with very acute scientific evidence. So that's all what we focus on. We've kind of covered almost all the sectors. One is, go outside and put. If it's for export markets, go to Sri Lanka. Indian rules don't apply. One is an open place. You can do anything, anywhere you want. You do it and then, that's what it is. But if it's for India, again, you have to. So go to Sri Lanka. There's a lot of companies who will be ready to. Two. Or set up a unit in Sri Lanka, which is not very effective. What is an open place today? You know, what you want, you can define it as a rule. There are a lot of countries who encourage Ayurveda and would like to take a bite of the international Ayurvedic pie, but we realize it as a potential, but we don't know how to handle it.
Which are the countries of pro Ayurveda? No?
Sri Lanka is one.
Yeah.
Nepal, I heard, is one. Nepal. Bangladesh has got a rule, but it's difficult to export because it's got a pecuniary. Even Nepal, that way. Sri Lanka is that way, very nice.
Is it Asian countries or is it European countries?
No, don't go into Europe. Europe is never going to make you live because there's a large pharmaceutical lobby which would not want you to be there. Because for them, the simple truth what they say is, every citizen in Europe has a million for a pharmaceutical company. They don't want to give you that million. So everybody is a million there. So a couple of millions make a billion, so they're not going to give out that billion to anybody other than them.
What about the
US is a good market. The question is all about, see, the international market is not the Indian market. And people don't, you know, some countries don't understand the word Ayurveda, some countries understand the word herbal. But then you can't make Ayurvedic products herbal, you can make, but it's all which dress you want to make them wear. But the question is, there's no point in talking herbal because herbal is generic today. Natural is generic today, organic is generic today. So if you are really making your mark, you have to make your mark with what you have. Then trying to be what everybody else wants you to be. Which makes it very difficult. But then, the fact is you have to understand regulations. It's not easy. You need to have the patience to understand regulations. So nothing is difficult, nothing is easy. Everything everywhere has a way. But the thing is, it's how you see it, how you understand it, and how you, I don't say deviate, but how you get it. And once you are in and your product is good, it's accepted and, you know, then you know everything about what you need to know. And then you can do everything what you need to do also, because if there's a market, there's a business. The entry is where the barrier is. That's how it is made. And across the world, if you look at Southeast Asia, there are all regulations. The regulations are across. Only thing is, it may not be in a format of Ayurveda, it may be format, but then that is the process of learning that we have to do. You invest time, you have to invest effort. The only way is, nobody is there to consult, nobody is there to advise. Nobody consulted me, nobody advised me, but then the point is, if you have to do something, you have to go after it and learn it. But then, the window is always open, it's not closed.
So, from your
speech
to what we understand, I started with traditional Ayurveda.
Yes.
Then gone to active Ayurveda. Then gone to nutraceutical. Then gone to Nutra Cosmetics. What is the next?
That is as far as you are concerned.
Kotakali is traditional Ayurveda still. Dandadri was also still Ayurveda. There are at the north, Dut Papeshara, Jandu, then Sevatram, we are not hearing about such organizations now.
Okay.
Is it they restrain to traditional Ayurveda? Is that reason they are not coming?
See,
another exception is maybe Himalaya.
Yeah. Good question. Two things about it. Now, I'll answer the questions in three different parts. Part one is where I would say about the North Indian companies which you know about and the South Indian companies. Now, number one difference is, see, if you look at Ayurveda, we all know Ayurveda as Ayurveda. Okay? But there is something called as the North Indian Ayurveda. The North Indian Ayurveda, if you really trace the roots, it's very greatly influenced with a lot of these Basmas. It's more from the Persian side, so they have all that. The entire system what they follow in the north is completely different from what we follow in the south. And especially in Kerala, we have a very pure form of Ayurveda which uses most of herbs. Not that we don't use the basmas, we use basmas. But that is a smaller part of popular use.
So,
basmas. Basmas are, see, there's a big...
Kashaya, Churna, Asana, Arishtam. Anything else?
Lehyas. Gridas.
These are the five castes.
No, Lehyas are there, Gridas are there, Basmas are there. Even in Churnas, there are like Rasas into, there are a lot of subcategories in Ayurveda. I mean, it is actually a science. I mean, I would say it is science. Much more than that meets the RI and much more that the modern research could really, interpret. It's a true science. I would honestly say it's a true science. Only thing is, I feel the present science or the current thought or the current scientific framework, so-called scientific framework, is not able to really, able to clearly explain or put it out into different buckets and say this is the same. Because the very philosophy of both the sciences, the frame is same, the philosophy is different. But if you put it down to a scientific frame, it will all fall in place. To answer your question, where would Ayurveda go? Ayurveda is going back to its roots. See, what is Ayurveda? It is not generic, it is not commoditized, it is not packaged, it is personalized. It is going to move into how today biotechnology is moving, where, genomics is moving. Where we are all moving towards that personalized medicine for me, for you and for him. That is exactly what Ayurveda is. It is not packaged. These are all new formats of delivery, new formats to reach markets, new formats for consumption. But it is all going to evolve. I mean, I'm not believing that this is going to work for like let us say next 30 years. No, maybe the next 10 years. We're talking about the next technological disruption where maybe the Ayurveda won't exist in the same format. It's going to come out in a different format. Maybe it's in a different combination with something. But the point about any science to sustain, to grow, is it should really evolve and embrace new science, new learnings, new thoughts to evolve. And that is where if you look at any country, any government, any place, anything which is sustained, it is embraced, but has not changed its format. It will change its process or its approach to create a new format, which will have this and that. But it has to be balanced and has to be responsive.
Now, what I can
explain,
I actually, Western Ghats is having the maximum number of herbal species in India.
It is a biosphere. Yes.
Portugal has made a compendium
of
more than 800 species.
Agreed.
How much is commercially grown or how much is the units like you?
See, we consume about 200 plus herbs at least. I'm saying at least. Our biosphere would probably, I mean, it's definitely a pressure flow, I think. There are popular herbs which are used.
Yes.
Popular herbs can be about 200 to 250. Not much of it is yet cultivated because cultivation has not become commercially viable yet because number one, there is no organized market yet. So yesterday somebody came to me and asked me, what herb should I buy? I said, the best thing is go find a manufacturer, get a contract from him for a price and a quantity and then you cultivate. It is a safe option. This is definitely going to have few shortages in 10 to 15 years. But number one, the skills, the native skills of identifying a plant is going over. Native collectors are getting lesser and lesser. So these are all going to be threats for the industry in the next 15, 20 years. Is what. But see, no industry stops. Then it will come out with a different avatar. Maybe, I don't know, maybe the new science will be used to, maybe in a lab, I don't know. Maybe, I've heard of technologies where you can harvest, like what we do with human organs, or you can harvest some parts of a plant I've recently had a talk with one of our fellow CMs,
Sam,
who was really wanting to check plant genomics, where he said, you can actually, you know, for example, Cartagena. Cartagena is where, you know, it's like, you know, it is like China, but then the question is, the moment you touch it, it can itch, it make you itch. So I said, I don't know whether I'll get Cartagena 10 years or 15 years later, but then he said, it is possible to harvest that part of Cartagena in a lab. So I'm just now extrapolating and imagining, you know, don't quote me on this, yes, to say, you said so and it is not, I don't know, that's just my imagination. But I feel that is what, that's how you must see things in the future. You can't say that it's going to stop. It is all going to evolve into a new format where you need to either embrace it or stop it. That's the process. But then the scientific validation is the critical part. Now when we change, normal question which I'm asked is, when you change kashaya, does it have the efficacy? Yes, it has the efficacy. That is where the crux of it lies. So if I can bring in what is there in the kashaya into a tablet, yes. In a dosage which you consume and you get the result, yes. I'm successful. But then that is a process where I feel many companies are not, I mean, everybody is looking at changing a format, but then if you're able to deliver, you know, the dosage equivalency to a tablet, that's what it is. Did I answer your question?
Now the new USFDA regulation, that is from the plants itself, herbs itself, it should be grown in fertilizer free land. How far
We are talking about good agriculture practices here. Now, Ayurveda, now if you really look at it, we are...
It should be fertilizer-free land.
See, the point is, the point is like this, you know, see, we're talking about GMPs. We're talking about GMPs now, which are like good manufacturing practices. Now, we have one GMP in Kerala, we have an international WHO GMP, we have a US FDA herbal supplement GMP as well. So that is what is accepted in the US. Now it has started there. Next it will go to marker compounds and other things, chromatograms and other things, where, you know, it becomes imperative for you to get herbs. Herbs which are cultivated in a particular region, because herbs cultivated in different regions will have different actives, different zones, different seasons, all can have different. So that needs to be standardized. So that is a process. Then comes the good agriculture. That's where I need to mark, I need to know exactly. Well, the traceability has to finally go into where, you know, it will later come into seed also. But I don't know whether that kind of a process will be very practical for Ayurveda, because we're talking about 200 or 500 plants from different biospheres. Now, how many biospheres will be able to cultivate it? Or probably it will be possible to do it in a lab, like, you know what I said, if you can curate a particular part of a plant, you know. So I don't know, but this is all science. So if that happens, great. If that doesn't happen, see, industry is definitely going to sustain in a different avatar. I don't know what avatar that it will be. Now if you've seen Cortical, every other company in Kerala, large so-called traditional companies, have all come out with tablets. The question is not anymore whether you like or you don't like. The question is, what does the customer want? You know, look at our lifestyles, it has changed. We have consumed a lot of moringa leaf, not anymore. We have consumed a lot of turmeric, not anymore. I mean, it is all part of our life. The question is now, if you have to survive, you need to adapt. If you don't adapt like the dinosaurs, you are going to be gone, you're going to be extinct. This is where I guess every company, now all Kerala companies are now coming out for a tablet. But we are going to the next level. So we would like to always go ahead of the curve rather than follow the curve and see, okay, now they'll come out and then we come out. No. We would go ahead, we'd like to extrapolate and say that, okay, this is how it is going to be. You may be wrong, you may be right, but we'd like to rather follow that path rather than wait for you to be hit and then say, okay, now what do we do? You can't do much because you're already late. So the way to sustain in a business is to really look at, you know, futuristic, which can even be technology. I will say I'm seeing technology as the biggest disruptor that is going to affect all of our industries completely. Our jobs. So all those things are going to definitely happen. So let us not shut our eyes to all that. Let us embrace it. Let us keep our eyes open and see how can we use that for growth. The only way is get your threat into your engine for growth. That's what we should never we look at threats as threats. Threats are always there. But how you embrace threat? How do you internalize it and how you make use of it is what is going to make you survive? Survive. I'm not saying successful. Success is another thing. But survive is what is very critical in this game.
Retail, like why is home to airports? So I understand you are building a premium brand. So is there anything special that you have started with so much of stores in airport, or how do you look at building this premium brand? So
Does the airport quote for premium or how? What is there any reason?
Excellent.
I just would like to add to that question. Is there like something like a cost per acquisition that you worked on for this retail model?
See, let me tell you, number one is the strategy. Let me just first answer the strategical part. That's what I said. It was a big experiment. It was a pure experiment. And, it was a pure experiment which didn't have any proof of success, any proof of knowledge, any proof of experience, any proof of research. It was pure gut feel, entrepreneurial gut feel where you get go in and you're ready to do a jump. That's it. And you jump. When you jump, then what options do you have? Either die, or you survive, or you make something out of it, or you succeed. So that's what I was telling somebody in between the tea. I said, we should only have one choice in life. The problem is, all of us, we always have two choices. What to do and what not to do. Just imagine that there is only one choice. And you made the choice. Then you go out and do it and make it what it has to be. So, I mean, there was no model, honestly. The model was that we got a store. Now we need products. We need design. We need the shop. We need store. We need operation. We need software. We need products. We need packaging. We need labels. And that's where we started. And, today from there, yes, we evolved. Now, yes, you talk to me about other things. I can tell you location. I talk to you about a lot of jargon, which is not critical. And this is not jargon. This is what is critical. It's not about the store. It is not about the product. It's not about anything. It's all about traffic. It's all about locations. It's all about the product mix. It's all about Acer. It's all about customer experience. It's all about customer service. It's all about CRM. I've given you enough jargon. So I can give you more. And tomorrow I'll talk about analytics, which someone says is already on. So this is where it is moving. Tomorrow maybe an artificial intelligence platform is something, believe me, is something which we are thinking about right now. Because to improve the customer experience. The world is moving in a different direction now. So you have to start, there is no plan. The plan is to survive. Every day you have to survive. Now when I say 24 stores, I know that I'm taking a challenge. I know, because the first thing today I did in the office was, I briefed my top team, I said, boss, we are getting in with a 70% or 140% kind of expansion. Now what is it going to create you? I said, definitely challenges and problems. Be ready for it. So I'm just telling you ahead that let us face it, we have decided we are going ahead. Two things, now they've talked about replenishment. Simple thing is replenishment. Now we are all consumers, we go to a store, we go to a mall, what do we see? Happy faces, good products, merchandise right, good, everything great, right? But it takes a lot of hard work to make you have that experience. Because you only have two options, one is it's good or it's bad. You think it's bad, you will never get it. You think it's good, you'll come back. And that option is only once. You're not going to come back the same. So that is the process, number one. And it was never that it was a part of the strategy, but because it was part of what we felt was right, which we did, which wasn't a good decision. But then we made good out of the decision, is how I would like to put it.
So you said, like, when you compare with a mall or an airport, so why do you see an advantage? Why?
It was again a stupid idea, I would say. Or probably, I don't know how to talk about it. People normally, when they see you successful, they say, okay, it's a great idea. But I think there's nothing called as a great idea and a not so great idea. It is what you think is right. I mean, what I thought was right is what I followed. I didn't go in and ask my friend, my neighbor, I didn't ask anybody. I felt, I went, I thought, I got, and that's my life. I mean, then it is my life where I have to make good out, number one. Second point is, once you're in, so a lot of people say, why it's a wrong strategy that you must have. Even when I go abroad, people say, why do you follow? The first thing we ask is, where is the airport and where can I get a space in the airport? And we go to the airport and we talk to the airport immediately. Now we understand the model. Now, you take a Dabur for that matter, they have a view. It's not easy to manage. Retail is an animal, it's an animal. It is an untamed animal. You have to rein it on it every day, and consumers are like snappy. He lost money, I lost money. Because he's going to think that I've cheated him. He's not going to think that he's made a wrong decision. So I have to think for the customer. So I have come out with 90 ml pack. So when I have an option, yes, it is his responsibility. He chose. But when I have only given him one option, it's my job. That's how customers think. Customers don't think like you. They think whatever they make, is you. They trusted you. So if you don't do right, you cheated them. No, nothing. I mean, you do what you want, but you don't do it, I'm going to kill you, right? So that's how, even we are like that, right? When we go to a nice hotel, we don't get a good charge. We're not going to be thankful.
There is one more logic to this airport thing. Normally we say that there is a value customer who looks for values of bargains, and the airport customer tends to be a lot more instant and extra core in his mind.
Impulse
buyer, as they call it. So we believe that a lot of people believe that, and you're also getting a creamer part of the mall visitors, right? Mall, you can't control who comes and sees, but then this is a slightly more curated set of customers. So a lot of people, I mean, of course Ajay's was much more instinctive, but when we do these market research for companies, and we suggest some companies to open their stores in airports, because you get those impulse buyers, and you get the impulse buyer who's ready to spend a lot more money and much faster as well. So if you look at any of these airport stores, they quickly buy it, right? So in Ajay's shop, there will be people who go and ask for, like, I go and ask for that, there is a sandalwood foot cream, which is an interesting product. And so there are people who go and ask for a particular product. I'm sure there are lots of foreigners who just walk in and ask questions on which product they're buying.
That's been one insight. Number one is, see, that's what I'm saying. More than the foreigners, it's the Indians. That's what I mean. I respect the Indians today. I respect, I love them, and I think that these are the guys whom I respect, because they are the ones who spend money. And there's no upper limit to money. Kind of, you would think people are crazy when the way they buy. If you look at the buying trends, you'll be surprised. But then, these are all insights you get, That's what I'm saying. When you deal with consumers, be it in malls, be it in high street, the insights what you get is what makes you very, very clear, confident, and also starts making you think more and more. When you do B2B business, you don't see your customer, you sell, you get money. That's all you look at, So it's all commoditized. You don't have any personalization there. And it's all about, what did I sell today? What did I sell yesterday? So that is not what it is. Every business has to be a curated process for the customer to consume. It's not bought, it's not sold, it's consumed. But till you can keep the consumption story right and right, you have a business. But it is a very sensitive balance. Second is, I'll tell you about another threat. Don't imagine that, that's what I said, the kind of rentals which I pay. I was telling somebody yesterday, I could actually, rent a three-floor apartment in an office building in Kotia. A three-story apartment in Kotia, could you believe it? For this much of space. Do not imagine the kind of risk money taking, not imaginable. I don't want to pay, because you'll all shake and shudder because it's not small. But that's the risk you take. See, risk is, that is what I'm saying. The higher the risk, the higher you need to be careful. That's what I'm saying. It's all in the model. It's like playing with a knife, You can use a knife for good or fire. You can use it for good purpose. If you don't use it for it can burn, So it's a different game. But we took that high risk game as a part of our strategy. Initially we could afford it, but today we're moving where but we're taking it because we understand the model. We understand the dynamics of the model. Now our products are used by consumers. So there are people who buy. So we already know them, they know us, so we don't compete anymore. So it is all about being available everywhere. That's right.
Your products are, sorry.
Do you have the unit economics, when you look at a space normally, we pay this much of rent, we have this much of sales from the space. So does that unit economics get right, or it's more of a part of the strategy or a brand business?
It can never be right. It can always be thought optimistically. Now we have to, one thing which I've learned over the last 7 years, I've learned to be realistic than optimistic. Because optimism doesn't work at all in business. Optimism is good as an entrepreneur, as you think anything, you have to be optimistic, imagining. But when it comes to spending money, realistic. And now I've started taking a pessimistic view, where I say, this is the pessimistic view that I would like to be. So what I'm trying to do now is, I'd like to keep my expectations low, my cost high, and if I'm able to sustain, and I'm not anymore looking at profits. Profits is not something in my dictionary, but making a profit is my need and my agenda, which I make. That is my job. That is an entrepreneurial role. That's a byproduct of a business, frame or a business. So the rest of it is kind of, so what can happen? If you don't want profit, if you have a cost, if you have an investment, what can you expect? Nothing, right? So whatever else you make, but to make a profit is the business objective. But that's why we require people, we require technology people. Now today, I know who buys, how many. We do adopt a lot of technology. We do analytics, we do a lot of stuff. I'm not anywhere there where I wanted to be, but that is where this whole war is going to be, fought. It's not anymore on the floor, it's in the bags. Anybody who buys now, I will be able to understand how the metrics work. So what I'm saying is, retail is not about it. Retail is not about the store, it's not about the front end, it's not about anything, it's all about the back end of it. And if you can manage the back end of retail, you can manage. Otherwise, it's not the product, it's not the company, it's not the knowledge, it's not the money, you'll flop. Retail is a different business process. Like any other business, like service industry or manufacturing, every business. So this is which I've learned over this. Why I say so is because I've learned it the hard way. The kind of money I lost probably in retail, I always say I could have gone into a couple of Harvard courses on retail and learned what to do or not to do, but I don't believe in it. But what I paid is what I learned. So the value I learned is what I got out of, busting money, but now I know what to do because I've already lost money where I have to. So now I know how to make money or how not to lose it. That's a learning, that's a business learning. So other thing is we had also the other businesses, other things, so we could experiment also. It's not like we were a startup. So that's what I said. Some business parts of our business already startup strategy, like online is a startup strategy right now. So we bring in that element of a startup in our company very, very high. So we encourage our employees to fail. We say, what can most happen is we fail. We'll come back. So I've had enough failures in my life, so I don't anymore. Right? Nobody's going to fail as much as I would do. Right? I'm the highest risk taker in the company. Right? So if an executive takes a small risk, how is it going to affect? But even today, I find people hesitant to take this decision because they feel that they fail. But I think that's where we're going. We should go ahead and take decisions. Right or wrong?
Your products are all. Only available through your own outlets?
Yes.
They're not distributed outside?
So, current strategy is to have it in our own outlets.
Both the healthcare as well as cosmetics part of it?
The range which is there in the airport is at the airport. It's available online across all the major marketplaces in India. We have our own websites. And
you also have a store in store, right?
We have a store in store in Zulu. Just a few store in store. Aster, we have a store in store now. We are probably having about 5 to 7, but that is going to be another part of our strategy. But we are not going to be an FMCG brand. We won't be number. So we are very clear about what we are going to do. Because end of the day, our customers are exclusive, they're premium, and they want something that is unique. They pay to get that unique stuff. They don't want to pay. Now, if you look at many brands today, and want to name them, the popular brands, which was at a point of time only available in hotels, like Biotic or something. Today you don't give it that much of premium because it's visible, available everywhere. That premium is not, premiumness is gone. So it is sometimes good to be premium and to be not available everywhere rather than be available and be there for everybody when they want it. So people tend to give it respect. I mean, this is the strategy. It is not, don't follow the strategy and that's what I mean. We do stupid things, but then we stand by it and we build out something out of it. Because sometimes you need to take certain stands which may be against popular. And the popular thought says, you have only 10,000 outlets, we have taken, you've only been so many outlets. But that gives you a value, that also makes you lose a bigger value. The question is, which value would you like to take? Would you like to take go the Himalaya way where you can be available across and make or would you like to be a niche premium brand which has respectability among customers? So we are giving that term a lot of importance, respect. We would like to be a respected brand than a popular brand. Respected brand will always have a respect. Popular brand will always make more money for sure, but the brand valuation is where it is all about. Because if you say you like this brand, this is because of certain elements. So that's what you'd like to curate at first, and then probably it might go into consumer segments also, but not as this brand. It will go in a different format, different label as coming out of the second brand, but it won't have the name of Bipha. It will have the learnings of Bipha, it won't have the name of Bipha. It might be even manufactured by Bipha. But product will be different, it will be differentiated, but the price points will be different. And it will be available across, but that is not going to be the least product what we have. And that way we are also sensitive where it is placed, how it is placed. Even if it is a hotel, we go to see the place, to see that the brand is kept right with the right respect. We cannot keep it anywhere inside. It's a big fear.
You spoke about the increasing number of products from 40 to 190 or so.
Yes.
So can you please little more about it, like how you identify the need of that product and major challenges that you face?
It is havoc. Product number of increasing. The best strategy is to have 5 products and sell one very well, and be a $1 billion company than making 190 products and trying to make money out of it. It's difficult to make money out of 190 products. Because all 190 won't sell.
So all these 190 products are available.
Not really. Not all of them. But what we do is we keep a very constant close watch on consumer feedback, and also the kind of information we get out of our stores. Number one. we look at reviews very closely, and we also, I mean, even I at times go to stores, interact with customers also. We get a lot of feedback from stores and store managers as to what. So there's a lot of feedback which keeps coming. We look at trends, we look at what sells, what doesn't, which category sells, what. So we do a lot of experimentation as well. You know, we come out with small batches of some products to see, test whether it sells. In some won't, we'll change it. We come out with a new packaging, we come out with a new strategy, maybe we'll delete the complete product range and then come out with a new range. It, you know, you need to do a lot of deleting, modifying to get the right product. It's not easy. And not everything is going to sell. Some people even shut it off after a couple of batches. So you cannot be emotional with products.
In the course of your journey, it was a good narration, a lot of insights into it. So you talked about had waves of opportunities and obstacles and challenges. And one thing that I picked up from your thing is that you had employee issues, like when you started growing from 7 to 10 to 14, at 7 you were good and 10 you stopped making money, and 14 you had started bleeding with you. So what were the kind of employee challenges? Because as an entrepreneur, when we try to grow, these are the things that we don't anticipate now, but then when you hit the wall, then you get confused.
Couple of mistakes which we did. As we grew from one to whatever numbers, we relied on people who were with us. So it was more on trust, it was more on familiarity than on professional skill set, knowledge, and so there was no proper parameter which we employed in.
This is the case with all entrepreneurs.
This is what happens because there's no plan. The plan is about growth. When the growth happens, you take some wrong decisions of deploying whom you trust. Whom you trust is not going to work the way you want, because they've been asked, they went, because they were told. But that we went on, that's why they said, we lost lakhs of rupees, monthly. Because these people went, they did what they were asked to, they didn't know what was going wrong. It was not their problem, it was our problem. We took the wrong decision, they followed what. Finally we'll say, okay, he didn't work, but that is not the problem. We took the wrong decision. It went on for about 1-2 years. Second is, we decided to have only Malayali employees across India, which never worked. Malayali are good in Kerala, not out. I mean, of course in Dubai or some other place, but not in Gujarat. So you need to know Hindi, number one. You need to have the kind of attitude where you don't have anything, you should be able to go out and talk. Nonsense. And still, that's fine. That's okay in there, because it's all about how skillful you are. But we are good. We are excellent intellectually. We are very knowledgeable. We have good understanding of life, but we don't know how to communicate. So that is where we flopped too. So we flopped many times, not once, twice, thrice, four times. We flopped. Now, we took a decision. No more of anything. We will hire a French guy, a Sri Lankan guy, a Gujarati, an Ashrai, no problem. But we found them to be very good. Because the point is, their attitudes are different.
There's no normal area in this room, no?
No. I don't want to be controversial, but rather I would want to know. See, no, these are all. I'm not saying Malayalis have respect for their intellectuality. We are amazingly great, intellectually capable people. The only thing what I say is, when it comes to work, the world needs somebody who's good to, kill. Who's aggressive, come what may, he should be able to dice, mince and chop. That has to be done. That is the job. But the Malayali would think, whether should I not? Whether or now or later. There's nothing in the world. The world, today we have one thing which we have is time and opportunity. That comes only once. If you have a customer in front, if you're able to do it, you get it. If you're being very nice and kind and you try to really tell about things, it doesn't work that way. So it needs quick thinking, it needs quick. But I'll also tell you another anecdote, like all the top retail companies in India has Malayali at the top. So I'm not trying to say Malayali is okay. Just that we need to adapt. And every Malayali anywhere in the world, any industry, retail, they're good. But the thing is, we have to shed our Kerala, cover out. And the change emissions out. And then we are the smartest of the lot, I think. We are the most intelligent. I wouldn't like to put any words less for that. But the point is, we have to, shed our inhibitions. That is where we are not, globally competitive. This is, I'm talking about us, we in Kerala. This includes me also. I'm not any.
I would just like to add to it, because we were trying to set up an office in Bombay. The first thing when we said for recruitment is, can we have Malayali?
Yeah, it's comfortable. It's comfortable, that's all.
It's comfortable to talk to them. So finally we said, HR, at least we need a Malayali, because we need to talk to them. Finally settled for zonal business head, we said, okay, perhaps we can't help it, you know, you need somebody from. But I've reached a stage where we even started talking, probably even online marketing, we need to regionalize. Because we can't understand the essence of what a person wants in Gujarat, sitting in Bombay, or sitting in Kerala. You can't understand. You don't know how to talk to a Gujarati or a Maharashtrian.
Exactly. That brings us to a very, very key point, which I think I would have...
You said that.
What I learned from this growth from Kerala to Mumbai to Jaipur and all was, the biggest hurdle we had was cultural. We never understand the culture. We only knew what we knew. And we just applied what we knew, and that we failed. Because end of the day, the attitude with which a Gujarati or a Maharashtrian or a Rajasthani is coming is completely different. You don't talk to them about what is nice about you, you talk to them about what appeals to him, that's all. Don't talk about Kerala, nothing, you don't want to hear all that. He likes Kerala. The moment you say Kerala, he likes it. He says, "Wow, this place is green, I've been there." But that's it, end of story. Now you talk about the product and say how this is going to benefit me, what price you offer. You offer a discount, which we don't, but then we don't still do that. But the thing is, now, that's what I said, if you have to handle someone, you will get somebody who knows how to handle them. Somebody who will go from here, you know, and will try to learn everything, and he fails. Finally, your business fails.
So, coming back to the care, your expression as a manufacturing product. So, there's a lot of queries that we've received regarding Ayurveda products for baby and mother care. And we understand that Bipha is predominantly focused on wellness and other lifestyle ambitions. What is it that Bipha has contributed towards baby and mother care sector?
Of course, the blood structure is the greatest contribution. We've come back with that product again. Vendraksha is basically something like a fairy magic. It's a very palatable, which can give you better, which can give any very better delivery of iron. Very palatable. We have certain formulations which are like the Ashta Churnam, you know, which used to be given as a churnam, which was always mixed with rice and given to every child in Kerala or many children in Kerala. We have brought it in a tablet form, but few people use it because of lack of knowledge of it. We brought Rasnari Potpuri, you know, it's very expensive, but very good quality Rasnari. But you know why? Because I remember those days when after every bath, my mother used to put that. I know the smell, I know. And you know what? The funny part about Rasnari Puri, the moment you put it on your forehead, you get bitterness in your mouth. You know, can you explain how it happened? That's how powerful Ayurveda is. And now you see hundreds and thousands of children going to pediatrics and spending a whole lot of money for cold, cough, and allergies. Simple things, 5 rupees, you get a ton. But then we tend to forget our heritage, our tradition, and we're all embracing new things in life. We're forgetting those very, you know, less expensive, very good products, and, you know, so we brought in that. Of course, you know, my grandfather was, you know, he used to be a very, you know, delivery, there was a time of, you know, where he was specialized in medicines and therapies for that period. We are planning to bring about it, but I think Rekha and all are already doing a lot of work there. I think she's very specialized, Rekha.
No, we are not entered.
Yeah, but they are on the way. They are on the journey to reach there. I am sure that, you know, every segment in Ayurveda, you take baby, you take mother, you take geriatric, you know, every segment of Ayurveda would get us millions of jobs, Because you have so much in Ayurveda, it's a huge science. Everybody picks up something and starts making good out of it. You know, I talk about a brand called Sridhari. I said one amazing thing which I loved about them was they only specialized on one thing, ice. And they're one of the very good, internationally acclaimed Ayurvedic centers in Kutagoro, not in Kuchin or not in Trivandrum. They solely specialized on one thing called ice. They've been phenomenal. Yesterday I heard about somebody who said, "I'm going to do only one thing in Ayurveda. I'm going to use Ayurveda for autism." I said, "What about ADHD?" He said, "No, autism." I said, "You are going to be an international center for autism." I said, "Please go for an ADHD accreditation because I can already foresee you as a success." Because you know why? He said only one thing, autism. You'll not deviate from that. That is a specific.
Isn't it ironic that people often associate Ayurveda with wellness and lifestyle as opposed to every other aspect of medical science? I think it took an Ayurveda doctor herself to tell me that we actually have surgery. We have departments of gynecology, we have But when you say Ayurveda, it's either A, I have a fractured bone and I need some massages to heal it, or I have a backache and I need some massages to fix that. Or maybe I've taken too many allopathic medicines, now I need to do that. Whereas traditionally, Ayurveda has to start from the moment that problem occurs. So, similar in case of baby and mother care, don't you think the awareness factor plays a significant role? Kacheta, you run a hospital as well.
The question is, see, number one is, what importance do we give to our traditions, number one? How relevant are our traditions anymore in our daily lives? The question is, we are giving it, see, we are on the way to embrace the West, forgetting our past and forgetting our... So, we are actually, you know, I don't know the exact figures, but in Netherlands, still deliveries happen, majority of the deliveries happen at home, not in the hospital. And we have this wonderful tradition, you know, where, you know, we have everything to do with that, but then it's a lot to do with awareness. Second is, how willing are we to embrace? Now, let me tell you one thing. We have this old tradition where we use umikari to brush our teeth. Now, how many people in this room are using it today? None of us. It's a simple thing. What is umikari? Umikari is, but then now yes, we buy a Colgate paste with activated dharma. It's precisely the same. But the question is, unless we are going to accept and embrace and popularize, it is not going to happen. Because if you don't take Chinese food or Italian food, you know, or hamburgers, today it's become popular. You know, how many people are talking about the virtues? But then you go to a place like Japan, they still follow the traditions for the food. It is more cultural. We have to accept Ayurveda. We have to first acknowledge, recognize, and accept our culture. Accept who we are, you know, as you know, a culture. But today we are moving away from our culture to something new and something modern. Whereas you see the Western world coming into Ayurveda, yoga, and you know, how many of us do yoga? I mean, I'm sure that there are definitely a couple of them. But then we are not the majority here. These are part of our tradition, which is not anymore, you know, popular tradition. I mean, popular life, you know, it is all about, you know, some minorities follow, some others, majority goes for other treatments. So unless we recognize, accept, and are open, how open are we? Now, let's say, forget it, don't embrace it, at least are we open to such a concept? I don't think. Now, we talk about, you know, taking kashayas and, you know, arishtas, you know, post-delivery. Lot of modern doctors would say that, you know, don't take it, it is full of heavy metals. Will you go, are you going to believe a modern doctor, or you know, still believe, you know, I'd like to take the risk of taking it? Even my wife was told the same thing. Don't take any Ayurvedic
formulas.
Ayurveda is all about the process. It's all about the process. For example, I tell you, would you believe, now what do you think about mercury? Is it poisonous, it is not poisonous, or is it safe?
It can be safe with the right quantity.
Yeah. Use it in
metals.
Yeah. But can you consume mercury?
No.
We have a product called as Rasabradulu, which is nothing but mercury, which is taken from, extracted out of a herb called as chayam. Chayam is a herb. This is curated or processed in turmeric and mixed with sulfur. When I say sulfur, I am not buying any chemical sulfur. It is again taken out of a herb or a bhasma. It's mixed by hand. They say ink blows a color and finer particle. It's used for rheumatoid arthritis and psoriasis. We don't sell it in the open market. It is only done, and you cannot, there are a lot of dietary restrictions. You cannot take fish, you cannot take, it works marvelously well. And we tested it with stove, but then, see, the only thing what we are not understanding is what in the modern terms is called as mercury, lead, or arsenic is not what it is. We don't put any chemicals into it. See, I'll tell you about Cartagena. Cartagena, you touch it, you know, it will eat you like crazy. Like China. But we process it in curd. There's a chemical processing that is happening, and then you can use it for wonder.
But there's a Bipha, maybe an exception, but there are several commercial companies where, I mean, I personally don't, I would not trust Dabur for many reasons, because I've seen so much of it. And I find it very difficult to believe that you know, you can produce chyavanprasha and all that in 2 days, 3 days and all those things, because it is a complicated process, it's a very elaborate process. Now how do you justify that? Is it wrong for a consumer to ultimately believe somebody, you know, in the modern day world where there's so much publication and all that available saying this is harmful, this is not harmful, when this is actually the truth?
See, the factor is, I tell you, by far, if you look at the Kerala industry, it's considered as even today. I mean, all whatever people call corrupt or non-corrupt and all that. I feel that Kerala companies are relatively much, much better off than any other company in the world for Ayurveda. Because there are only two clear reasons for it. Number one is, most of the Kerala companies are family-owned and generation. So I said, the biggest cost which I would have if I deviate is my brand, which has been built up over decades or generations of 50 years. I should not lose it for anything in life. It's built up over, you can't just lose it. So that is a big responsibility that is on top of you, which you can't deviate. So this applies to, I would say, about 80% of the, you know, companies in Kerala, number one. And you know, we were talking about this Kerala quality. You know, I feel, of course, we run businesses enterprises, but I think we are very true to ourselves to a good level. You know, businessmen are not considered, you know, to be very straight and all that, generally. But I would say that I don't believe in that statement, but that's a general popular perception when people talk. But I feel Kerala always tries to bring better quality than others. Now, the third part of consumer getting wrong, it is the consumer to decide today. See, the consumer today has to take, you said about that, that is your choice. I have certain choices which I won't speak here, but that's my choice. Where I consume some other company's products also, like I talked about a company called Sri, because I respect them for what they do. So likewise, there are a lot of good, I will talk about a company which makes nasal drops. It's from Mumbai, I'm not saying every company, they make respectably good products. So there are good companies which make respectable products, which make very good quality products even today. But it is for the consumer to choose what they want to consume, because you cannot go by, you know, a chyavanprasha, because you have to take a solid decision. Now within Ayurveda itself, you know, which company's oil would be good, that is a choice. A doctor also takes a choice. That's what and that's what I said, the Kerala Ayurvedic fraternity is a very stringent Ayurvedic doctor. That is why it is well preserved. So that's why only good companies can survive. Because you're a big company, you know, somebody asked about Vaidyanath and Charak, you know, they've not been able to let their foot into Kerala much. They're very, very big in India, not in Kerala. Vaidyanath or, you know, I mean, it is in Kerala would be one of the few markets where they're not strong. Get out of the Kerala boundary, they're big. But that is what is Kerala about. Kerala is about puritanism to the highest level. But they keep it and they can preserve it. That's a bane, and then this also a blessing. It is all how you see it.
A person I met recently told me that the modern society has given us MRIs, ultrasound, things like that, which have helped reduce infant mortality rates, etc. And I mean, the science has been in India like forever. Yet, when Ayurveda existed, the longevity of a person was not exactly in the most appreciable standard. And today we are talking of how to go Ayurveda to live longer. Don't you think it's sort of, what is your take on that?
I'm not sure about the infant mortality side because I don't have the proper
science.
I would say it's all about, let's see it as a lifestyle. First of all, Ayurveda is not a medicine system. See, we've complicated the whole concept of Ayurveda to be medicines to be cosmetics. It's not so. Ayurveda, in fact, only recommends you one thing. That thing is all about responsible living. You live responsibly, following, the right practices in life. And Ayurveda is one system which really has written it down very clearly as to what and what not. It's very clear. It has got a Ruthucharya, it's got a Dinacharya. You know, how many people follow it? If you follow it, actually you don't need to really worry about health problems. The question is, today's lifestyle, today's life, you know, how many of us can really practice it? You know, even if I want to exercise, I may not be able to exercise because my lifestyle has become, you know, so infested with travel that, you know, I won't be. These are all realities of life. Now, let's face it. Now, that is the reality of life. That is where, something came as, supplements. You know, I can't take a turmeric every day if I'm in a daily, I'm in a different country.
That this element of the body is going slightly to right, and that will lead to that is already evident.
It's true, but then how much the point is, the science has said, but can we, are we able to embrace it, follow it? That's the question. If you're able to follow it, you just have to just practice it and follow. See, I know of a lot of people who live responsible, when I say responsible, you know, like, it's not to say that eat vegetarian, this is not about Ayurveda. And this is what people would like to talk about, but that's not true. The point is about being balanced in what you see, what you eat. I mean, like, a lot of people talk about virudahara, like, you know, don't take the curd with a fish. How many of us really believe it? These are all, I mean, if you look at it scientifically, it doesn't work at all. But if you believe it, it's a good way to probably, you know, follow what it says. So the question is, how many of us can really follow it is a bigger question. Now, they say don't take ghee with milk, you know, dairy products, but these are things which we do every day. We mix a fish curry with a curd. These are all things, but then don't ask me what happens if somebody dies, I don't know. But the question is, this all has some toxins which is probably generated, which gets into our body, which is, that's where, you know, panchakarma and, you know, where, you know, detoxification processes happen. So if you can follow, like, yoga is a great way to keep your mind and body, you know, it's an amazing way to do it. So likewise, if you follow an Ayurvedic lifestyle, I'm sure that it can keep longevity for a definite, you know, number of years. But then I don't have a status to say, you know, if you follow Ayurveda, I don't know about it. The question is, you follow a responsible lifestyle, that's all what Ayurveda tells you. Doesn't ask you to consume kashaya, nothing. So there are certain foods, there are certain seasons, there are certain daily rituals you follow.
Ajay, I just want to ask you the more fundamental stuff, you know. You have heard that, you know, when you are young and all that, you know, so Ayurveda is all about three things. Vata, Pitta, Kapha. Do you still relate this to all your modern approaches like your wellness? These concepts are still valid?
I think the concept that is a fundamental. It is true. That is a fundamental principle of Ayurveda. So they talk about the perfect balance of Vata, Pitta and Kapha to be health, and any balance of it to be ill health. So that's primarily what it is. So essentially, you know, when you're talking about a product level, it is not possible to do that. Honestly, because a product becomes a product. It becomes a product, a consumable product. But, you know, if you go to an Ayurvedic physician who's a very seasoned physician, that's exactly the principle that we follow. There are two parts of Ayurveda. One is the therapeutic side of it, and the other part is the wellness side of it. Wellness side is more related to a product and the health and wellness. Whereas the curative side still follows the same thing. So that's where it is still practical.
So that's just like.
Actually, you see, now from what you mentioned, you know, your product range, one is the Ayurvedic formulations, which is made in the traditional method. Then you have the high value cosmetic products, and then third one was the coconut oil cold press products and all that. So now out of these three ranges of products, where would you be concentrating more in terms of growing the company? That's one thing. The second thing which I wanted to ask you is that these high value cosmetic products which you are retailing through the counters and all that, how do you reach out, or how do you advertise or reach out to the first
Two questions. Number one is, we are still investing on the core of the business, which is the therapeutic side of the business. I've been very quiet about it. I've not talked about it at all. I have not talked about what we did there, except that we have sold. That is the core of the company. That is strong. That is a ground on which we are. That's on the level. This is going to be a slow growth, but going to be sustainable growth. This is the plank on which Bipha rests. It's the ground. Everything else, what you see on top, is a spontaneous, spurt that, you know, that adds to the total kitty, making it a larger company, more visible company, making it a consumer-oriented company. So this is where we are investing on in real terms, scientifically validated products. The product for HPV, now we're coming out with the product for vitiligo, we're coming out with the product for eczema. So all that is going on. The retail side of it is equally being invested on to come out with more products, more consumable products. So we are seeing it as a three-pronged strategy, one which is going beneath, which is strong, which is building the base. The second, which is popular, which is in the face, and which is like consumable. The third side is the services side of the business. And the fourth is a digital transformation side. So finally, all what we are making has to go, consumer should be able to consume it digitally. This is the thought. So, you know, anybody can consume anything.
at the comforts of their home. So this is not the services, but everything else. So we are trying to make Ayurveda more consumable, understandable, and follow, you know, kind of, you know, something which people can follow easily. So we're trying to simplify it, communicate it with the right, you know, right people in the right process, right channel, and also promote the response. We don't want, that's why I said, I don't want to talk about anything which, you know, makes people fail. I would not want to promote it. That is a very clear thing. We have products, of course, which can help people reduce weight, but I don't give you any guarantee of product. This was a question which was asked. My job is not to give you guarantee. But we give you a guaranteed product, but we don't give you a guaranteed result because we can't. I can't sell you a product for hair, you know, it says, no, because what happens is the moment you add to this, the moment you create expectations. Not that any of the oils are bad. The question is, now somebody will only want to reduce hair fall, somebody would like it to grow 1 millimeter, other would like to grow 1 inch. So how can I control expectations? That is where companies pay. So advertisement and media makes expectations which you don't have full control over. And if the customer is not getting what he or she is paid for, as per their perception, you are in the soup. They only say your company is bad. And you can't get over it because you don't have a choice. But here, we allow them to do a, take a responsible decision after listening to somebody, reading somebody, doing the research, and then take an informed choice of purchase. So he cannot, she cannot. Now, if at all someone says that, you know, we still feel that, you know, I paid more and I didn't like, they can come back, put the product on the table and say, give me a refund, you'll get 100%. 100% refund. That's where we said we guarantee. We don't want anybody to take any product of ours and say, hey, you cheated us. Don't. Please give it back. Even if you're a consumer, it's okay. Because we don't want to hear why you like to take the product. So those are guarantees which we bring into the process also. Now, media, I'm not sure we will be a very media visible because our agenda is not to be visible and be popular. We'll be visible, but not, we don't want to be popular as the popular kid in town. We'd rather like to invest more digital. We are going digital. We are spending lots of money on digital media. We have huge belief on the digital media because we are only reaching targeted customer and to people who are seeking it, who are wanting it, who are following it. We don't want to be everywhere in front of everybody's eyes and would like them to decide what we have. We'd like to be only going to the target audience at the targeted time, to the target region, and just be in front of it. That's all. So we won't be visible. I mean, we're only visible. We don't want to be popular.
Allopathy is based on method of science,
yes.
And Ayurveda is based on historical knowledge.
I wouldn't fully like to say that because I definitely allopathy is made on methodology, methodological science. I would agree on that. Ayurveda is definitely having a scientific methodology. Only thing is whether we were able to explain, understand, and you know, kind of define. That scientific knowledge is where the question is. See, now what is happening in the name of research across India is just validation of what is known. So when you say, I want a scientifically validated product, that only means that I believe in the science, but let me have the document to prove that, you know, it's been given. Now, that has been done for centuries in Kerala and India. This has not been documented. So in fact, the only process that we need to be focused on is the documentation part. And when I talk about this turmeric and you know it became big or ashwagandha became big in the West, is not because somebody introduced ashwagandha, they just gave it to 20 people and then they said out of 20 people, the 16 people found this, that's it. So it is not that anybody is creating new research, they are just talking it in a language that is understandable to the world, in the way they think, in the way they better understand. So it is not the science that we need to change, it is a language we need to change. The language that people understand, the language that people currently think on. It is not that, you know, it is not a traditional thinking. It is a world which is more based on tangible quantitative thing. We make it a tangible quantitative thing, so that is better understood. So this Sanskrit was at a point of time used as a language, or maybe, you know, but not anymore because it's not in popular use. That is all. It's not that it's a bad language, it's a great language. But
that, is that the same for Patanjali
group? I would not want to. I still respect them, but I would not like to compete. I don't say they are bad because they have created. I'll tell you the positive side of the story.
They
created a new awareness for Ayurveda.
They project they sold the material from Himalaya.
I don't want to comment. I tell you because it's not right for me to talk about a brand. But what I would say is, people have different opinions about Patanjali. A lot of people ask me the same question. I would say I respect Patanjali. Only for one thing, they've created an awareness among the masses about Ayurveda in India today. So the moment, and internationally also. So today, since Patanjali is becoming popular and becoming a big
new biscuit. The good thing is there's renewed interest into Ayurveda, into products, into. And I think it's taking Ayurveda to the next level of double-digit growth. So that has in fact created a lot of stir. If you look at a typical Hindustan liver, what they bring to Ayush is not because of them, it's because of Badassi. If you look at an ITC, everybody is talking Ayurveda. A natural salon is now coming out with natural Ayur. Hindustan liver is coming out with Ayush. So there's going to be a lot of, so that's what I'm saying, it's all waves of, bursts of, that will be there, that will remain there for another 5 years, 6 years. So you'll see a lot of things, after which you'll see another, maybe it will be the downward spiral, then it will come out with a different version. So this is going to keep on happening.
I came across some Ayurvedic studies by different international organizations. So I don't know whether it's true or false, but I went through different sites to get those documents. One of the interesting facts was the quantum physics is connected directly with the Ayurveda according to the European universities studies. The second thing, what like a cow urine, which we treat as a bad, Americans have given patent. And they are coming up with a cancer tablet, and it will come here as tablet for us. That is an interesting fact. And there are a lot of things related, like the cow urine as well as camel urine from Middle East. They have the same content. The tablet form is coming towards us. Turmeric, again, cancer. American Cancer Institute is doing research, and they have coming, but they will put different name because they have some different. Humorin, something technical name they have put. The technical name. And it is coming back to us as a tablet, as an allopathy. So, when you go deeper, what I found is there are two set stages. One is preventive, and then there is a medical treatment stage. What I understood from whatever my understanding, knowledge, Ayurveda is purely on the preventive side. And the medicine is once you get into trouble. Like it's like going to the repair workshop. The other one is just to protect yourself from getting into that, before getting into that workshop. So that is my, even I have started a brand in Africa, but for financial reason there was war happening, so I had to leave the country. I started a brand named Preventive Measures, like in Tanzania actually. And it was picking up, but there was political situations, a lot of things happening, so I had to. Yeah, because the people age there, at the age of 45, people start dying, and in the political level, people start dying. I think you know the situation there, and I was also researching on that. Since I'm an IT person, but I still have those
things. I was rephrasing that to say Ayurveda, modern medicine protects, Ayurveda strengthens. Because from personal experience, I had a fracture.
Go back to European University.
Yeah, so I would say that, but from a personal experience, my father is an allopathic physician. So I had a fracture, and I had to immobilize my thumb for 2 weeks. And in the end, I had begun flexing. This is predominantly what Ayurveda specializes in. Ayurveda also has the same technique of immobilization. It's just that they immobilize one particular section of the body. And you can use the rest completely fine. Your entire hand or your wrist doesn't lose strength. Whereas in allopathy, you put the plaster one bone below the fractured bit and the entire arm becomes immobilized. So I would say it protects so that when you have a calf, nothing happens to it. Just that your entire arm becomes useless in 2 weeks. Whereas in Ayurveda, it strengthens, continues to strengthen your arm and gradually strengthens the other part. So I would like rephrase that as instead of saying it prevents and the other one treats. It one strengthens and one protects.
I would like to put it this way. It's more, I feel, it's not anymore about what is good or what is bad. It's all about having an integrated approach towards it. You know, nothing is bad. See, for an infection, you should always take an antibiotic. Yeah, I have an infection, I go take an antibiotic. That's it. I mean, don't talk Ayurveda. You have a problem, you have a cardiac arrest, don't talk about it. I mean, they say Dhanadhar Mulya has an example. See, that's where you need to go for the modern science. But for integrated, lot of prevention, lot of post surgical care, I was talking to one of the CMs yesterday, we're taking our cholesterol down, he said, please bring it to, he said, it's doing magic to my triglycerides. So there is, it's not about this is good and this is bad. It's all about, you know, there should be that, you know, approach where we could all pick and choose. The doctor should be able to pick and choose what is good for the patient.
Yeah, integrative medical approach.
Yeah.
One last question.
Yeah. I think looking at the future, maybe 2 or 3 years down the line, what kind of growth do you see for you in terms of turnover?
Yeah. It's a good question. Honestly, we are going through quite exciting time. I mean, in terms of growth and next year's figures are not small. It's about growing by double or whatever number of digits, because you know it's about scale now. It's not anymore about incremental growth. And lot many more verticals of Bipha will be coming in place, like consumer division is going to be launched in the next year, but we won't advertise. It's a different model that we follow. We have witnessed growth over the last 4 years, which is very reasonably sizable growth, is what I'd like to say. And next year we're expecting double of that. So because we are increasing our network of stores, we are increasing our prescription, exports is going to really pick up in the next year, because we have to do registering in about 10 to 12 countries. We have a regulatory department. So when I'm saying something, it also means that there's a lot of things in the back. It's not just created because there's an opportunity. It's created, it's carefully curated, it's carefully built, it's carefully put in place. Then only we can take this opportunity. It's not easy. But these are things what we were doing for the last 5 years. Now we had manpower. Now we are putting a cluster-based approach across India. We have an East cluster, we have a South cluster. And we're taking people from the best corporates. We're taking people from GMR, and we're not taking anybody less. Putting in slightly higher one, but that'd be okay. We want our results that basically how we're looking at it. But we're very clear what we want. So fingers crossed, I'm sure that we will have a good year in the next year is what we're working on, because already we are increasing our retail store chain by 70%. We're expecting to close it, which was last year's target. But we've already covered 7 by today, signing up. We are expecting it to be 140%. There is 14 stores will be mostly operational by 100% by January is what we're looking. And 140% is what we're looking by March. And if this works out, we are then looking at not 6 stores, we're looking at the next 40 stores. So probably we'll raise, because we're getting a lot of vibes from the merchant banking industry, the financial industry. We're talking about valuations and all that. So, because, you know, end of the day, you have a concept which is, and today this hot, the sector is hot. People are there who are willing to put in money to your company, buy out your shares. So I'm looking at scale. Now, the moment I get a scale, I'll raise funds. Because now, I mean, that's what I'm saying. 25 stores is my game. 40 stores is somebody else's game. But if 64 stores makes us leap to the next level, that's what the whole business is all about. And that's what business is all about. It's not anymore about how do I grow from 1 to 5 and 5 to 10. Yeah, it takes you umpteen years. But those years are over. Now it is for you to, you know, really scale and do it. But then that is, you won't have another chance also. You're not going to do the second chance. There is one chance. So we're already talking. It's not like we've never gone into anybody. We're getting a lot of vibes and people are really after us to talk about. That's what I said, when you build a brand, that is where the valuation starts. It's not about your company, it's not about your product, it's not about your business, it is about the brand. The brand starts getting visible, accepted and recognized, it starts creating valuation. And valuation is where the whole business today should be based on. It's not anymore about profits. You create valuation, dilute or later sell off. I mean, I even have a targeted valuation which I've kept for myself, and I said, this is the money I get. That's the moment I'll stop and retire. And I'll probably be mentoring or, you know, I'll be investing into companies. I wouldn't be doing this again. I wouldn't have the energy or the passion to do it. I can only do it once. But then if I get that kind of valuation which I've already put in place, I'll definitely stop. And I'm sure that there are a lot of bigger companies, international companies, who are willing to take up good companies with good products, good concepts and good models. So there is potential. I mean, it is not anymore. And this applies to every industry. Even if it's a turmeric or a coconut oil, this applies. So it's just that I'm narrating you my experience and the way I think, because this is also evolved thinking. It's not 5 years back, if you would have talked to me about valuation and say, this was my company, my family's company for the last 80 years. Now I don't say that. Next 5 years, if I get a good valuation, please have the key with you and let me go for the time. So I would have loved to be toiling, because it's not easy, huh? Because you need to really work hard and be on your toes. You cannot do it on your entire lifestyle. You have to somewhere say quit and do better things. Like, you know, work for charity, do social work, and I said, I like do all that stuff instead of, you know, being on numbers, talking to people. But, you know, it's a process. It's a process. Now, I was driving down, I was talking to my retail manager. So, you have to keep constantly monitoring, motivating people. It's not easy. So, you have to really spend time for that. For example, my wife met with an accident yesterday. She's hospitalized. But I said, we have to come here because I'm committed to it. And that's business. Everything is taken care of. But, you know, that is how you need to dress. That's probably a hard part of your life, but then that's what you need to take. It's a choice. One is, I can sit at home and say, you know, my life, yeah, that's fine. It happens. As long as it's not dangerous, it's okay. So that's, those are the kind of plan you take, which you need to take.
Okay, Ajay, one.
That's the last question.
Yeah. You are increasing your retail and outlet markets to meet that demand. So how is your manufacturing? Is it a complete automation or partial?
We're not, the tablet side of it is completely, it's semi-automated. The cosmetic side is still manually done. But today morning, we have already decided that, you know, we are scaling up. We are setting up a WHO GMP plant in the next year, which will have an investment of 6 to 10 crores, which will be world-class plant, you know, that's what, because we're already visible. See, the problem about creating a brand is once you're visible, you have to have everything aligned to that. Even your receptionist, the phone, the voice, everything is... So everything has to be, and again we are increasing our capacities also. So we are foreseeing an investment of about 7-8 crores in the next year. And retail, yes, we are now. We've started on it as a side business. Today it's becoming one other main business which we're building. So we are now thinking, we have already acquired assets, industrial assets over the last 5 years, but electricity, power, everything. So we've curated that too. So we're getting into foods also, not foods as in food processing, but health foods and stuff. A small unit in Bipha. So we are experimenting with different things because we see value in all this. Not that we'll be successful in everything, but that's something that we can now incubate within our company. So that's what we're doing. So manufacturing now will be a different vertical. Food will be a different vertical. We'll start spices. We're coming out with perfumes in the next few months. We're coming out with herbal teas. So all this is getting scaled. And it's all
my partially order.
Sorry?
Partially automated.
I think it has to be fully, it won't be fully automated because we don't want to see that kind of volumes as a Dabur or a Patanjali. We like to have controlled volumes, controlled quality, controlled value. We want to give value. It's not about how many we use, it's all about how many tens of thousands or how many thousands we sell is what will make us very happy. Because we do not anymore for making to the masses. We like to make it to those few people or those special people who like good quality. Good value for money. That's
fine. So, we've almost come to the end of our 15th CPC. I have attended 13 out of the last 14. So, one I missed when I was in abroad, where I was just thinking, you know, how many I was counting. So every time I said, you know, like I said in the beginning, when I get out of this door after this thing, I feel that this was the best. And today I am 100% sure that it's going to climb going to do that. You've done an excellent job.
Thank you.
You will agree with me. And the transformation what you showed was fantastic. Our concept of Ayurvedic dispensaries, stores and showrooms and all that, this is something I remember, it's called pharmacy. Name pharmacy always is the lines of bottles over there with all those, you know, cogs protruding out and all that, you know. So that's all changed completely. The whole thing has been transformed into a different level itself. So I think this is an eye-opener for many of us, I think all of us. So thank you very much,
thank you.
Ajay.
Thank you.
Thank you from the bottom of our heart.
Thank you very much. I totally enjoyed. I must also thank you. I think it's been a great audience. I think there have been great questions. I mean, I love interacting with people, and I really loved interacting with you all. Every time you talk, you also learn a lot of things. You also learn new perspectives, and I hope I've been able to give some amount of something somewhere to somebody. And I'd love to see you all probably, you know, creating your experiences in the future. And I'd like to see a lot of successes coming out of this room. in the future, because I think I've also been helped mentored by a lot of people, and that's what I do now. So everywhere I go, I'd like to try and see what I can do to see how, you know, anybody in Kerala or anybody anywhere can be motivated to go to the next level. Because what we all need is that leap of faith, that leap where we need to jump. But if you think that is there, please jump.
I also thank all the audience. You know, I think that we have a right proper mix today.
Yeah, sure, that is
great. All of you, in spite of the festive season and all that, have come over here. And I can assure you that we are going to continue this initiative. Please come back in January. We are going to have another senior charter member sharing his experience next month. So in the meantime, let me wish you all a very happy Christmas and happy New Year. See you next year.